The BBC presents My Music, a musical panel game devised by Edward J. Mason and Tony Schreier. And here's Steve Race to introduce the team.
Well, of course. On my left are David Franklin and Frank Muir. On my right are Ian Wallace and Denis Norden. I shall ask them questions involving music, and they will give me answers involving prevarication, bluff, and just occasionally a startling degree of musical knowledge. Right, gentlemen, first of all, a little instrumental music. One mark for the title, another for the composer. And we begin, as usual, with David Franklin.
Circumstance.
Number one, do you want to give me the opus number?
No, I don't.
39, you're right.
It's one thing that I want to keep private.
Well, you're quite right, opus 39, Pomp and Circumstance, March number 1 by Elgar. Later on it becomes Land of Hope and Glory, of course, as you were about to remark. Two marks for you, David, and we move on to Denis Norden.
Every seaside summer show, which has a complete change of programme, in one of the programmes, the second half will always open with Invitation to the Dance, which will be this.
Yes.
What do you want, the chassis number? No.
I'd like the name of the garage that supplies it.
Marek Weber.
Who Weber?
Marek.
Oh, no. Oh, you're letting us all down.
Well, I tell you that I once did a summer show and he was down in the program as Marek Weber. And we didn't get one person asked for their money back.
Marek Weber made records in about 1920 something or 30 something.
Yes.
This was another Weber, an earlier one.
Oh, was it? Then,
this was Carl Maria von.
Yes, Carl Maria. He was called Carl Maria because his mother wanted a boy and his father wanted a girl.
Just to give our scorer, Val, something to do, we'll give you 1.5 for that, I think, okay? And we move on to Ian Wallace. Glorious mud.
Yes, I'm very tempted to say, in fact, that is by Michael Flanders.
It's a Flanders sort of
thing. Yes. Well, Michael Flanders has done a very interesting modernization job on Mozart's Horn Concerto.
Yes.
But that was a spot of Mozart, I suspect, being played by Dennis Brain.
No, played by Barry Tuckwell, actually, but Dennis Brain, of course, did record it, and so did Alan Sybil. Horn Concerto number...
I'd have a go at number 4.
Very good, in
E
flat.
Yeah, flat.
Two marks, because I like the cut of your jib, right?
I like the cut of yours.
And on to Frank Muir. Matter
the Russian, Russian composer,
yes.
Mr. Chosky. Mr. Kosky. Christian name Chai.
Yes.
And it's the waltz from the Sleeping Beauty.
Did you know that, or did David tell you all of that?
Well, I sort of semi knew it. Well, everyone does.
Two marks for your side, Frank. And we move on to the next round. Opera. Very often the story of an opera ends on a splendidly dramatic or moving note. So we've taken the last scene or episode of an opera and we ask you which opera it is. Title, please, composer, and approximate date of first production.
Dreamer.
I can dream, can I? David Franklin, a retired merchant sea captain, advises the hero to get into his boat, sink it, and destroy himself. He does so. Who, by whom, and when?
Peter Grimes.
Yes. By, composed by?
Benjamin Britten.
And first production?
Sadler's Wells, June 1945.
Yes, was it wet or dry? That's 3 marks for that without any question. Denis Norden, here's the last line of your opera synopsis. The hero, sore as he is from the elves pinching, demands one rousing song to end the frolic.
Is it? Wait a minute. In the May Wives of Windsor, there's pinching fairies. Wait a minute. There's writing coming up.
Keep
yes,
going.
The Whole Staff by Verdi, first produced on Thursday, June the 3rd. 18, and the moving finger stops. 19. I have a correction coming up. It's 10 to 19, apostrophe. It was 18.
1 mark for Falstaff, 1 for Verdi, and what was the year you said?
1800. 1900. 1900.
Yes, give or take 10 years, you're right for your 3rd mark. Painfully earned. 1893. Ian, now it's your turn proper. Praying for forgiveness, the hero embraces his son Theodore for the last time and dies. Which opera by whom?
Theodore.
Theodore. It's Theodore.
That was the clue, of course.
Well, that makes it sound like a Russian opera.
That's correct.
Mussorgsky.
Thank you. That's very helpful. Yes. Well, name 10 operas by Mussorgsky.
we'll start with Boris Godunov.
We'll end with Boris Godunov. Yes. Yes. And what year?
1882.
Oh, that's near enough for 1874. Yes, 3 marks. Frank, try staging this in your village hall. She rides into the heart of the flames, whereupon the river rises in flood and extinguishes the fire. Hagen is drowned, the curse is ended. Which opera ends like that?
Naughty Marietta.
As far as I'm concerned, that's 3 marks.
There's a low rumble in my ear which says it's to do with somebody called Gertie Demeron.
Yes.
A Wagnerian composition, I recall.
Yes. Could you, on your own, essay a year of first production?
Wagner. Wagner was 19th century.
Yes.
And one would say, what David, would one say, would I say? What? 1867.
Well, it's good enough. 1876. 3 marks again. Moment, thanks to a lot of help from the chair, David and Franklin and Frank Neil lead by half a mark. Well, next round. I must explain, after the last programme, we were talking about the songs that we most dislike, these you have loathed. And I'm going to ask the members of the panel now, and we'll sort out the marks afterwards. David Franklin, which song do you most loathe?
The Flower Song from Faust. Do you want me to perform it?
Yes,
briefly.
Gentle flowers in the dew, be message for me. There's a soppy thing, isn't it? I'm sending a flower on a message. And I've also very much objected to it because of an extraordinary mistake in the English translation. You see, Zebel, who sings this song, is a man sung in the opera by a woman, has been cursed in the first act by a mysterious stranger, Mephistopheles. And the particular curse is that every time Zebel touches a flower, it will be withered. Well, this upsets him a lot. And having sung one verse of this song, he then sees a stoop of holy water in which Margarita crosses herself on the way to Mass every morning, and he says to himself, ah, if only I will dip my fingers in the holy water, perhaps this will remove the mysterious curse from it. But he says it's in French. And then he says, in the original French, voyons maintenant, let's have a look now. Voyons vite, let's have a quick shufte. But this is translated in the standard English translation as, I will try the magic charm tomorrow. Doesn't dip his finger in the holy water, but still kids himself that his flowers are now not withered. And cue for song, gentle flowers in the dew. He sings another verse of the whole thing, and I think the whole thing is sloppy.
Well, that's your guess. Denis Norden, what's your unfavourite song?
Do you know a song called Le Fiacre, which all French singers who do spots on television and so on, they always sing Le Fiacre, which is, you know, it's the English, Un fiacre les trottinants, oupla, oupla, you know. And I always say to you, I know, what I want you to do is go... Now, A, I can't do that without getting particles of food over my lapels. And B, this is what they always do. They always say, they always tell you the story of Le Fiacre before they sing it, you see. And I know the story of Le Fiacre, and I'm tired of having it explained. It's a very weak joke anyway, and it doesn't become any better by having to go all the way through it. I say, stop Le Fiacre.
Ian, what's your unfavourite song?
My unfavourite song, among a number of unfavourite songs, is Come Into the Garden More. Now, I think I am influenced in this by the fact, and I think a lot of people are influenced in deciding what is their unfavourite song, because the first time they heard it sung very badly. Certainly, the first time I heard Come Into the Garden More, it was sung by one of those very, very throaty tenors. Come into the garden, Lord, for the black bat night has flown. And this puts you off for a... Thank you. I have always been very allergic to the Christian name Maud. I think, again, because when I was a little boy, anybody who was called Maud was generally some very stout, forbidding-looking elderly lady, because there aren't really very many young ladies even then who were called Maud. But they all seem to have rather sort of fruity... So I couldn't really believe that anybody would want anybody like that to come into the garden.
And on to Frank Muir.
Songs I don't like are those... Don't hear them. Thank heavens all that much, but there's drawing room ballads. Typical ones are, one song, I have but one song. Only a rose. It's not worth bringing, is it? It's three roses at least, and there's one, I have so little to give. It is audibly so, normally. I suppose it's all summed up in another one, which goes, I travel the road. Who cares?
Thank you. Well, now, assuming that you, the members of our studio audience, agree with one and one only of our panel, I'm going to ask you to boo each song in turn. Boo the song of your choice. You ready? First of all, David Franklin's Flower Song from Faust. Right, next, Denis Norden's Le Fiacre. Ian Wallace's Come Into the Garden, Maud. And Frank Muir's medley, including I Travel the Road, Who Cares? Well, that's 3 marks, I think, to Ian Wallace for Come Into the Garden More. next round, you're going to hear the introductory bars only to certain songs. Can you please name the song? David Franklin.
Give her the first 2 lines. Frisch trabe, besonder rast und ruhe mein gutes Ross, durch Nacht und Regen.
I always said I ought not to be the chairman of this thing. What is it called, please?
It's Jack talking to his horse.
Well, you know,
chucker, asshole.
it's called Auf der Brücke. By
yes.
Schubert.
Yes, 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 yes. Thank you very much. Two marks. Denis Norden.
I want you to come home. It's still good. It's as though a voice. I get these voices. You know. And the voice said, who is Sylvia?
What did
I know
reply?
It's another question.
Who is Sylvia?
By Schubert.
Yeah, by Schubert. Yes, your voice has been doubly successful too much. And it's Ian's actual turn now.
Ave Maria.
Yes, but which?
We've done all right on Schubert up to now, haven't we?
Well, try him.
Yes, I will.
Yes, 2 marks.
Can I just add the information? I don't ask for a mark for this. I just do it to try to keep up the intellectual level of this program. That Ian's song was written in the same year as mine. They were both written in 1825.
Which was 15 years after the formation of the Gaslight and Coke Company.
Frank, have you anything to say before your sentence?
Doug is guilty.
Well, here's a song you'll probably enjoy.
Type, I have to go back to the end before it comes to the title.
It's my girl. My girl.
It's an Irish ballad.
Yes, you're right. It's Moya, my girl. It's spelt differently, but it's usually sung Moya. Quite right. Let's have a look at the score. Positions now have been reversed, and Ian and Denis lead by 3.5 marks. General musical knowledge of one kind or another. David, yours is operatic, because that's rather your line. David, there's an opera in which the leading male character neither sings nor speaks a note. Who is he?
Neither sings nor speaks a note?
He's a mute.
Well, there is the leading male character.
Mm.
There's a mute in Entführung, but that's not the one. He didn't twitch.
Got you off the hook there, Steve?
No. Pardon?
Got you off the hook there.
Yes, he did, didn't he? I was just going to say, it's time they got another chair. Now, you don't know the answer.
Oh, no.
Really the leading character, Toby, in The Medium by Giancarlo Menotti. Toby the Mute. Denis Norden, what do you understand by Bear Stearns?
Some kind of lullaby type of song. Mm.
From the French?
Bercer.
Mm. Which means to?
To sing a lullaby. Fight me on this, Steve. I'll take you every inch of the way.
Rock to sleep.
Bercer, Berton. Bersigneur is a lullaby singer. Bessoigneuse, like a lullaby song.
Any more? Bestissimo, very lullaby. Yes, two marks anyway for that. And we move on to Ian. A double question, Ian. Who is the music critic who became a cricket writer? And who was the music critic who became a playwright? Two different people.
Well, the music critic who became a cricket... It's very difficult to say that, isn't it?
Yes, I found that, yes.
Is Neville Cardus.
Cricket writer, yes.
And the music critic who became...
A playwright.
Was Bernard Shaw.
Hmm. Bernard Shaw was originally... do you remember his name when he was a music critic? What did he call himself?
No, I don't remember
that. Corny de Bassetto.
A bit
and Corny de Bassetto.
Well, I believe
Yeah, well, that's what he called himself. And Sir Neville Cardus, the cricket writer. Yes, two marks there. Frank Muir, what are muffled drums and how are they muffled?
Muffled drums are usually beaten to the rhythm of the slow march during military funerals.
Hmm. Yes, that's fair enough.
Not a drum was heard, not a funeral note. No, they didn't have any then. After Corona. They're muffled by causing the noise to be less loud than it would have been had this process not been undertaken by those wishing to so muffle the drums. The black crepe, I'm sure, enters into the thing somewhere. I should think they stop the skins resonating to get the muffle. Wow. They probably just hang a bit of dyed cheesecloth over there. So when they're smote,
yes,
the noise is less.
That would
more pee-pee, as we musicians say.
That would do nicely. You cover the drum with something, or you use sponge-headed sticks. Perhaps that would do equally. Anyway, two marks there.
If you didn't use any sticks at all, it'd be even softer. Miss them, just mime.
Or stop them just short of the drum.
Yes, as at Corona, yeah. Now our special feature entitled Sing Along with Graham Dalley, or Gems from Denis Norden's Childhood. In short, gentlemen, we ask you to pick up both tune and words from where Graham leaves off. David Franklin. With the words.
The soldiers of the Queen, my lads. Dum ba dum ba di da ba da da da. It's the soldiers.
And when they ask us, how
we have
to belong
everyone and say the soldiers of the Queen.
Yes, near enough. When they ask us how it's done, we'll proudly point to every one of England's soldiers of the Queen. Three marks, I think, for that one. And on to Denis Norden.
The break of day.
Morn.
After the dance has turned.
Leaving.
After the
funeral. Gone.
Many a heart was breaking. If you could see them all. Many the heart that is broken.
Certain imprecision about the words from the audience. Many are hopes that have vanished after the ball. Three marks, you'll be pleased to know, Denis. Ian Wallace, your turn.
I knew that first bit. I have heard the mavis singing his love song to the moon. I have seen the dewdrop clinging to the rose but newly born.
Pardon me while I clear my throat. I think
green flag in the voice to go on.
Yes, that's jolly nice. Do you happen to know the title?
Yes, Bonnie Mary of Argyle.
Yes, three marks there. And a song for and from Frank Muir.
Dear, dear.
It's the key to take.
Pick your own key.
Dilly's dallying in the wrong key for me. It goes, tell me, pretty maiden, are the many more at home like you?
Kind sir, there are.
There's proper girls and simple tell me, pretty maiden, what these very simple girls will do?
Kind sir, there are delightful and proper girls of mine.
Yeah. 1.5 for Frank, 1.5 for Muir. Very good duet, totalling 3. And that brings us to the end of this edition of My Music, in which Ian Wallace and Denis Norden win by 5.5 marks. Goodbye.
Taking part in My Music were David Franklin, Frank Muir, Denis Norden, and Ian Wallace. Graham Dalley was at the keyboard, and the chairman was Steve Ray. The questions were compiled by Edward J. Mason, and the program was produced in London by Tony Schreier. The BBC presents My Music, a musical panel game devised by Edward J. Mason and Tony Schreier. And here's Steve Race to introduce the team.
Well, if you've heard us before, you'll know that Frank Muir and David Franklin are on my left. If you haven't heard us before, you won't know that competing against them in musical knowledge and chairman baiting, we have Denis Norden and Ian Wallace. We begin with instrumental music. Gentlemen, one mark for the title, another mark for the composer. We begin with David Franklin.
That nice Mr. Mendelssohn, isn't it?
Yes, that nice Mr. Mendelssohn, you're right.
And it's one of Mr. Mendelssohn's symphonies, isn't
mm-hmm.
it?
Yes.
And it's Mr. Mendelssohn's Italian symphony.
Mm, yes.
No, it isn't.
Yes, it is.
Oh, it is.
Oh, yes, it is.
I got the wrong twitch then.
Yes. Yes, symphony number 4 in A major, opus 90, the Italian, so-called because, David...
He wrote it after an Italian holiday, during an Italian holiday, a visit to an Italian restaurant.
What a penetrating brain you have. Yes. Yes, the Italian symphony written there, or after going there. I don't know, frankly. Anyway, you get 2 marks. And it's Denis Norden's turn. Is it on the tip of your tongue, Dennis?
No. Is this a bit when they go pizzicato? Ian, without much hope on his face, at Liebesdraum. And the lack of hope was apparently absolutely justified. I've whistled it and danced to it, of course, but it's a real toe-tapper, but I honestly don't know its name or origin.
Now, I think I know where the Liebestraum thing came from. The same composer wrote a piece called Liebesfreud. Perhaps that's where it came from. It was Schön Rosmarin by Chrysler, Fritz Chrysler. Oh. No marks, I'm afraid, and it's Ian's turn.
Mm-hmm.
another brain teaser, Ian, isn't it?
Ba-dee-a-dum, ba-dee-a-dum, dum, dum,
dum,
dum, yes. Dum,
curious, isn't it?
I got a sort of feeling for Schubert here.
I'm glad you have a feeling for Schubert. I hope you always have a feeling for Schubert.
Not here.
You'd have done better with
not,
a feeling.
Not here.
No, you'd have done better with a feeling for the lead here. It's the part of the Coppelia Ballet. Yes. Played from Act One. One of those tunes everybody knows, but
well, I don't realize that 100 lines.
Yeah. No marks for your side, I'm afraid, over there. And it's Frank Muir's turn.
Does it go has sudden shock chords later on, isn't it? Isn't it? This is sheer fantasia, my dear.
It is sheer fantasia, yes, that's right.
It's the Sorcerer's Apprentice.
Yes, by
Heinz. Who?
Duca?
No. But naturally, it's by Duca.
just say it and you get a mark, yes.
Duca.
Paul Duca, yes, French composer. The Sorcerer's Apprentice by Duca. You're right for two marks. Every one of them earned. And we move on to another round. Odds and ends of musical general knowledge. David, who composed what he called Waltz No. 1 in D-flat major, Opus 64, only to have it given two nicknames after it became popular?
Well, tell me the nicknames.
I'll tell you one of them, if you like. Yes, the Dog Waltz was one of the nicknames.
The Dog Waltz?
Hmm. I think it could be said that you don't know.
It didn't have an opus number, it had a heat number.
That wouldn't be the Dog Waltz.
Opus number K.
Do you write a lot of piano waltzes?
Yes.
Chopin?
Yes, that's right. Now, D flat major waltz, the Dog Waltz, or the something else waltz?
The very short one?
About a minute.
Yes.
In between 59 and 61 seconds.
Yes, you get your two marks here. Chopin.
Is it really called the Dog Waltz?
The Dog Waltz, because it was said that Chopin improvised it to represent Georges Sand's dog running round and round after its own tail. That was said to be false. So also is the title the Minute Waltz, because it really doesn't take a minute to play. If you play it properly, it takes about a minute and a half.
All we've got really left that is genuine is the name of the composer.
That's right. Denis, who's rather good on old films, as I flatter myself I am, may remember a film in which a young Hollywood starlet played the Minute Waltz on the piano against a huge stopwatch. Do you remember this, Denis?
No.
Oh, well, forget it. Anyway, two marks there.
It's not your question, is it?
Was that my question?
No. Oh.
What a relief.
I asked you that for what's laughingly called interest.
Oh, but
frightened as bear.
Never mind, eh? Two marks for David Franklin. Dennis, it really is your turn now. Dennis, a three-part question. Who found his inspiration on the east side of the city? Who had a Victrola? And what did Gershwin do with a chord in G?
You're on your own.
Yeah.
This comes from the Tenement Symphony.
Yes.
Which was sung by Tony Martin.
Yes, that's good enough for who found his inspiration, yes. Who had a Victrola?
Well, in the Marx Brothers film.
Yes.
The Big Store.
That's right.
Now, what was it?
Who had a Victrola?
Victrola. It's the girl upstairs.
Probably Nola.
No, it wasn't. They weren't playing Nola on the big show. No, I can't remember.
The Cohens,
Pianola, the Sarkellis and their Victrola.
Good enough. And what did Gershwin do with the chord in G?
He finally diminished it.
He proceeded to diminish
proceeded
it.
To
yes,
diminish
that's
it.
A very well won two marks.
Yeah.
Ian, we all know the opera called Tannhäuser by Wagner. I'm assured it's pronounced Tannhäuser. But that's not its full title. It's Tannhäuser and what?
For the theme.
Tannhäuser and...
Some.
Whitehäuser.
You don't know, do you?
No, I don't.
Tannhäuser and the contest of song at the Wartburg. Tannhäuser und...
Oh, I thought that was the Meister thing.
Sänger, let me say it, please. Sängerkrieg auf Wartburg.
That's a catchy title.
Yes, that's okay. Further flip side, Rienzi. Anyway, no marks.
I'm going to apply for an honourable discharge.
And we revert to English now for a question for Frank. Frank, the great light operatic success around the turn of the century was Floradora. No doubt you've heard of it, but who or what was Floradora?
I can sing you a duet from Floradora.
Do.
Tell me, but never do it the way I sing it. It's a sextet, isn't it? Floradora. Floradora. Oh, it's a girl. Some girls, you know, don't like sitting on chairs, and they rather sit cross-legged on the floor, and that what a girl like that is called Floradora. It's all in the plot.
Thank you very much, yes.
It's in the book.
It is all in the book, as you say, but the whole point is it isn't a girl's name. So I'm afraid that's no marks. Floradora is a bottled perfume or an island in the Philippines.
A likely yarn.
A likely yarn or not. The score so far shows me that David and Frank, whether they deserve it or not, are leading by 4 marks. And now, on any piano that may be convenient, I'm going to play you the opening bars of some well-known children's nursery rhyme. I want you to name it. Well, I don't really want you to, but the producer would like it. So can you name the nursery rhyme, please, David Franklin?
Right. Hickory dickory dock.
Yes.
The mouse went up the clock.
The years roll away, don't they?
Yes.
Yes, good number, always has been.
Two teensy weensy marks. For Davy Franklin. And a nursery rhyme for Denis Norden.
Well, it's Yankee Doodle.
But I said nursery rhyme, didn't I?
Jack and Jill.
Sing it then.
Jack and Jill went up the hill to get a pail of water. I was the nearest.
First performed in Beirut in 17.
I'm going to give you a mark. I've got down here Lucy Lockett lost her pocket, Kitty Fisher found it.
That comes from the Beggar's Opera.
Tookie Tawdry got the reward. Ian, your turn for a nursery rhyme.
Are you sitting comfortably?
Because the shock you're going to get is that I don't know it.
One a penny, two a penny.
Hot cross buns.
Yes, 1 mark each bun. Yes, 2 marks there. And nursery rhyme for Frank.
Underprivileged childhood. Throw your ball into the air. We used to sing operatic airs as children, and we were not permitted these rather frivolous tunes and lyrics. I'm afraid I can't help you here.
Well, I
just have to find out for yourself.
Well, I do.
Education
know.
Is knowing where to find a thing, not necessarily knowing.
Just for interest, does anybody know that one?
No, never heard of it.
There were 3 little kittens put on their mittens to eat some Christmas pie. Meow, 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 meow. No marks there, I'm afraid.
I don't think my childhood was underprivileged. I think I missed a damn thing.
It's terribly difficult to eat the Christmas pudding with their mittens on.
Ah, well, that's another matter. And we move on to another round. Some very well-known pieces of music, though not perhaps the bits you remember best. Title and composer, please, mark each. David. That nice Mr.
It's Mendelssohn.
Yes.
I knew that.
old friend.
You flaunt your knowledge, do you?
I haven't a clue what it is. I warn you, I should be absolutely furious with myself the moment you tell me what it is.
Well, do you know, I was surprised when I heard this. It's from the wedding march.
Weather in the vest.
Oh, but I was out of the church.
Shall we give him 1 mark out of 2 for no reason at all?
Yes.
Right, 1 mark out of 2 for it being a hard question. Here's an easy one for Denis.
The third man, theme.
Yes. And the composer?
Anton Karas.
Yes.
Well done. Yes.
2 marks. Do you know whose band it was, not of interest? Starts with an X.
Xavier Cugat is the only band I know.
How did you guess? Yes. No extra marks for that. Now to move for... it was. Yeah.
Oh, I guess.
Yes. Yes.
That's it's all. The organ.
Yes, that's right.
But I'm not going to waste any more time.
Well, by the time he gets to this bit, you're outside the church being photographed, actually.
Well, it's the wedding march, then.
Whose?
The other one.
Well, that comes the one. The one was, that one was Mendelssohn, so it's not. It's the other one from Mendelssohn.
Yeah. Oh, Ian, you old bluffer.
Yes, Wagner.
Yes. I think 1 out of 2 again.
Yeah, I guess
okay, 1 out of 2. Wagner's Wedding March. Wagner's Wedding March from Mendelssohn's Lohengrin. No, it's from Wagner's Lohengrin. Frank's turn.
Oh, yes. Oh, dear. How awful. This is on the tip of my foot. It's a bit of ballet music, isn't it?
Well, you could dance to it. People have. Anybody in the audience know where that came from? Claire de Lune. Yes, you're right. Claire de Lune by Debussy. And we move on to another round. Music from, as the posters have it, Sunny Italy. Title, please, for 2 marks. David.
I have it upon the very best authority. It's the Carnival of Venice.
Yes, great favourite with cornet players.
Oh, is it?
Cornet, they do.
Oh, triple tongue.
Yes, that's right. Ticketer, ticketer, ticketer. Yes. What am I talking about? 2 marks. Yes. It's Dennis's turn.
You can sing this whole song using just the 2 words, Santa Lucia.
Cheers.
Well, no, I can't. I don't believe it.
Santa Lucia, Santa Lucia, Santa Lucia.
Santa I believe you.
That's all very well, but what's the title?
Yellow Submarine. Yeah. 2 marks, anyway, for Santa Lucia. And an Italian song for Ian.
Torna Sorrento. Or back, come back to Sorrento.
Yes. 2 marks there. And Frank, your turn.
Something or other, da-dum-da-dum, said the funicular. It's called funiculi, comma, funicular.
Exclamation mark. Possibly.
In
You're absolutely right. According to the scoreboard here, which is called Val, thank you, Val, at the moment, David and Frank lead by 2 marks. On to film music. Just the film title, please. David.
Oh, I need to see the film.
Dr.
I've got a bit
of tobacco on the tongue. Dr. Zhivago.
Zhivago. Yes. That toddle in town.
Dr. Zhivago. Yes, 2 marks there. Dennis.
It was a Western.
Yes.
It was a big Western.
That's right.
I meant you could get an ice cream in the middle. I don't know which one it was. It wasn't Red River, it wasn't Shane.
No. The film The Alamo.
Oh, The Alamo. I never saw it.
No. No. Don't know. Anyway, no marks there. The tune, of course, was The Green Leaves of Summer, but the title of the film was The Alamo. Ian, your turn. Helps to know the plot.
Yes,
of this one.
Well, we know the tune, of course, is Waltzing Matilda, which takes us to Australia.
Mm-hmm.
Town called Alice.
No, it was a bad guess. It's the wrong guess.
What was the other one? The sheep one. What's that one with
Chips Rafferty?
I bet it had Chips Rafferty in it anyway.
It was a very long time ago, was it not?
It had Gregory Peck in it, and they were
gone. On the beach.
Yes, I think for one, Mark, don't you? You had a bit of help to get towards it. On the beach, yes. Which was set in Australia, of course. Marvellous story. And Frank Miller.
Yes, it's another Western, isn't it?
Yes.
In length, if not in depth, it's one of the psychological Western, or large Western. Don't know. It's not the big country.
No,
that's
no.
That's different.
Not the famous five.
Oh, the magnificent We Are Seven.
Yes. Yes, for one mark. The Magnificent Seven. By this time, our listeners will be all agog for the Franklin Norden Wallace Muir songbook. Graham Dalley, appropriately plugged in and switched on, plays the start of the song, and we ask you to finish it, please, gentlemen, with the words. David.
Come, landlord, fill the flowing bowl until it's half seas over. Come, landlord, fill the flowing bowl.
Till it doth run over.
Until it doth run over.
Wasn't that with me, maybe?
For tonight we'll merry, merry be.
Wasn't that with me, maybe?
For tonight we'll merry, merry be.
Anything?
Don't spoil my decrescendo. For tonight we'll merry, merry be. Who's got the next line? Oh, tomorrow we'll be sober.
David Franklin is appearing at the Old Bull and Bush. Yes, 3 marks for that. What else? Denis, among your fragrant memories will I'm sure be this.
Oh, this is closing time.
When it's spring time in the Rockies, I'll be coming home to you.
Good night, Charlie.
You don't need more of that, do you?
No, I don't think so, no.
Kind gentleman.
Kind gentleman. As you walk him round the block, his forehead's gone all shine.
Yes, little sweetheart of the mountains with your bonny eyes of blue. Once again, I'll say, I love you while the birds sing all the day. When it's springtime and the Rockies far away. 3 marks. Ian, your turn.
Oh, Genevieve, sweet Genevieve, the days may come, the days may go,
but still the heart of
memory weaves, sweet memories of long ago.
Your sweet memories should have been blissful dreams. No mind. 3 marks. And we turn for a
marvellous prompt to you.
And we turn for another song to Frank Muir.
Da 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 da.
Hi. Hi.
Hi. I like to sip the honey sweet from those sweet lips I see. I love you dearly, dearly, and I hope that you love me. You are my honey, honeysuckle, I am your BBC.
You are my honeysuckle, I am the bee. Kinky, I always think. Anyway. Remarks, you'll be surprised to learn. And that brings us to the end of this edition of My Music, in which David Franklin and Frank Muir win by 2 marks. Goodbye.
Taking part in My Music were David Franklin, Frank Muir, Denis Norden, and Ian Wallace. Graham Dalley was at the keyboard, and the chairman was Steve Ray. The questions were compiled by Edward J. Mason, and the program was produced in London by Tony Schreier. The BBC presents My Music, a musical panel game devised by Edward J. Mason and Tony Schreier. And here's Steve Race to introduce the team.
Hello and welcome to another contest of musical knowledge between, in the red corner, Ian Wallace and Denis Norden, versus in the blue corner, David Franklin and Frank Muir.
No political significance.
We start with a round of orchestral music, which you should recognise, gentlemen, without any difficulty. 1 mark for saying what it is, an extra mark if you can name the composer. We begin, as ever, with David Franklin.
I've had a very helpful suggestion from my friend, Frank Muir,
the well-known musicologist, who thinks it's Schubert.
It's a rotten thing to say.
But I don't.
You know me better than think I'm going to fall for that one.
Well, there was no harm in trying, was there? I think it's Mozart, and I think it's the Serenade, Eine kleine Nachtmusik.
Well, one of you gets 2 marks and the other gets none. You get 2, David. It is Mozart, Eine kleine Nachtmusik. Denis Norden, some music for you.
Ah, yes. I'm indebted to an anonymous correspondent.
Thank you, Ian.
For the title Pavan for a Dead Infanta by... Pavan for a Dead Infanta was Reginald Forsyth.
Out of the abyss of my musical knowledge, I'm able to tell you where you went wrong right at the start. You were thinking Reginald Forsyth's Berceuse for an Unwanted Child.
He also wrote Pavan for a Dead Infanta.
No, he also wrote Serenade for a Wealthy Widow. Let's not go into it anyway. This was by Ravel, and you certainly get 2 marks. Ian, your turn.
Yeah.
I'm sure Margaret Lockwood played it in 7 or 8 films.
Yes.
Everyone gets that feeling.
Which I think would make it Chopin.
Yes.
As it is Chopin, it is a study. No, it's not a study, was it?
He wrote it in his study, that's what you meant.
Of course I did.
At night, probably.
Yes, it was a nocturne.
Oh, very good, yes.
In fact, you could say really that was a nocturne up for the book.
I think you get your mark. Your 1 mark out of 2. It was Nocturne Opus 9, number 2 in E-flat major by Chopin. I was making up that bit about Margaret Lockwood. It just felt like Margaret
Lockwood. Yes, it was very helpful.
Good. 1 mark then. And here's the music of Frank.
Towards you, David. Trying to hope of experience. You're on your. That's not the name of it. Can't be called you're on your own, can it?
On your own, baby.
It's a well-known piece of music. The name of which temporarily escapes my memory.
Yes. It escapes your memory at some length. You'll know the moment I say it. Night on the Bare Mountain by Mussorgsky.
The Etude in the Nude.
Well, for those who find bare mountains distasteful, it's sometimes known as a night on Bald Mountain, you know, which I find distasteful, but that's purely personal. You get no marks there, I'm afraid, and we move on to the next round. David Franklin, a certain pop star adopted the name of a 19th century composer. What was the name, and what was the most famous opera composed by the original owner of the name?
The name was Lulu.
Hump.
The name was Humperdinck, Christian name Engelbert. The most famous opera composed by the original owner of the name was Hänsel and Gretel.
2 marks there for David. And Dennis, what is the Tarantella, and how did it get its name?
Tarantella is a dance. And it's got its name. It's Italian, and it's a sort of very jolly, you know, sort of, and they would say, Signor Americano, you must dance because nobody works when it is fiesta. Yes, sir.
I was waiting for you. I didn't know whether you were just leading them up to the, because I think I can help on this.
I have no doubt you can help.
Anyway, it is the dance that one is supposed to do as first aid if one is stung by a tarantula spider. Because they say that if you go on dancing hard enough, this will work the poison out of your system.
It's the same with nettle rash.
That's a nettarella.
I'm going to come in there. If you are bitten by a tarantula spider in Taranto, you may catch a disease called tarantism, and the cure is to dance the tarantella. As you said, Ian, you're right. Well, between you, you're right for 2 marks. Ian, a famous composer had built, to his own specification, an opera house which was erected solely for the performance of his own works. Who and where? Don't know.
No, yes, you know, as you say, it's one of those that you want to know.
The audience know. Wagner, yes, and Bayreuth.
Bayreuth.
Yeah, no marks, I'm afraid. Frank, what is a tattoo and where would you expect to find one?
A song about it. I've got you over my skin. You mean musically, I presume?
Yes, I do really.
That's
yes.
Rather coarsely worded question. I presume you mean musical tattoo is the thing you sound, the thing military sound. You sound a tattoo, don't you? Pum, pum, pum.
Yes.
And it's a call to the military.
Yes, I'll give you two. The music of bugles and drums recalling soldiers to their tents or quarters at night begins with a fanfare called the first post, ends with the last post. That was the original sense of tattoo. Of course, there are now tattoos in such places as Edinburgh and Delft and Arnhem and so on. Tattoo, very good for 2 marks. Or to 2 marks, I'm sorry. Missed my chance there.
He's got to go.
He's been at this all day. He's overexcited.
I've been out in the rain, actually. Trouble. From them, which musical shows, gentlemen, do these songs come? David Franklin. Lashing up the orchestration again.
I think that's sweetly pretty. And this sweetly pretty music, which means a great deal to me personally, comes from... What did we say it was? The Vagabond King.
Yeah. Yes. 2 marks. And a song from a show for Denis.
Most attractive lady in the first row has murmured new moon. I don't know whether this is a arrangement for a meeting or the title of the work.
Well, you're doing all right either way, aren't you? Yes, 2 marks. There it was. It was indeed new moon. And Ian. A very attractive young lady in the front.
Yes. Can you come back next week?
Ian.
Rosemary.
That's right, for 2 marks.
Thank you. Yes.
Shall I give you one and the young lady one? No, two
but
to
it
you.
It would save time, really.
Which young lady is it before you ask me my question?
Who is it?
Got her.
Frank, your turn.
Falling in love with love is falling for maybe. Falling in love with love is playing the fool. Failing so much is fun that you and I can see. Learning to trust is just for children.
That was sung by the young lady in the front row.
She enunciated beautifully. Yes,
isn't she? She doesn't know what it's from, though.
I thought it was usually sung by Alan Jones and such. Isn't it the boys from Syracuse?
Yes, sure. Or 2 marks. Very good. Opera. For 3 marks, in which opera by which composer would you find the following characters, and what sort of voices have they? Soprano or tenor or whatever. David Franklin, Benoit.
Benoit is bass, character bass in Bohème.
By?
Oh, by Puccini.
Yes, for 3 marks, that's right. Denis Norden, Wolfram.
Wolfram? I wouldn't even find it, I thought you'd find it in a chemist. Wolfram. Ian, you doing anything tonight? Wolfram.
Sounds like a spot of Wagner to me.
Yes, that's a mark.
Yes, it's just because of the doubly sounding of the V, isn't it? Yes.
Have a go at the Flying Dutchman.
I'll have
go
a go
on,
at
say
Dutchman.
The Flying Dutchman.
The Flying Dutchman.
No.
The Flugelhorn.
It's,
Nice,
you get a mark for Wagner. Wolfram appeared in Tannhauser. The type of voice would get you an extra third mark.
Well, it's a masculine voice. Tenor? You think tenor?
Say tenor.
Tenor.
No.
You're toying with me now.
And now
you've got strange faces, man. I'll sit in the front row.
Now, once again, we've heard from Ian all the time, and now it's Ian's turn. I don't know how he does it. Ian, Amneris.
Amneris is in an opera called Aida by Verdi.
Yes.
And
he's a male voice choir.
She's
a group.
Impressionist. She's a mezzo.
Well, I have down here another word.
A contralto.
Yes.
Yes.
So let's not argue
or
invite any male. They're rather interchangeable to a degree, aren't they? As 3 marks anyway.
Thank you.
And Frank, Marguerite.
Well, we haven't got a bit of folk Wagner here, but she's French, Marguerite. Is she the lady who knew Damo about camellias?
No. Out of the abyss of my knowledge, I am able to tell you no. It doesn't say so anything on my card,
is
but no.
By or about?
She sings in Faust.
Oh.
Ah.
She sings in Faust?
Yes.
I hope I said that with a sort of conviction.
Yes, it's pity you didn't say it at Faust, didn't you? by...
Guno.
By Guno, yes. What kind of a voice?
Can I just say...
Very, very excellent.
Yes, marvellous, yes.
Can I say in defence of my partner that there is an English version of Traviata in which the heroine is not named Violetta, but in fact is named Marguerite, so you were right, Frank.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes, 3 marks it is. Yes, 3 marks. Very good. Let's move on, for pity's sake. Let's move on to surer ground for me. Pure identification, this by sound. David, there are 3 artists in this recording. Can you please identify all 3?
Thank you.
pianist was Gerald Moore.
Yes.
The contralto was Failure.
Yes.
The soprano's a bit more difficult. How about Isabel Bailey?
Very good for your third one.
Follow that, Denis.
Like after say, the Lord Mayor's show now.
Bring them on. Bring them on. Five of them. I will identify while smoking a cigarette.
Denis, you have the chance of getting three marks for one name. Here it is. Domani qualcuno ritorna troppo tardi ma a cercare di me tornerà. Get that bit, that's the clue.
Yes. I think it's Sandy Shaw.
For three marks, you're right. Benny, yes. And now Ian Wallace. Yes, interesting, Ian, is hearing that, isn't it? Who was it?
John McCormack.
Yes, that's right, for three marks. And so we come to an item of identification for Frank.
It's a number written by Tom Springfield.
Yes. Yes.
And Jim Dale.
Yes.
And it's sung by, it's either the Searchers or the Seekers, I can remember. No, I mustn't have any help, please. I'm inclined to think it's the Seekers.
Yes, that got a Hollywood Oscar, that song, didn't it? Jolly good for our two lads there. Yes, the Seekers for three marks there. David, you're first here. From the description given, can you please identify the musical celebrity? Born Naples, 1873, died also in Naples, 1921, but for the last 18 years of his life, he made his headquarters in New York. Who was he?
Died in 1921. Oh, Puccini.
No, you're a few years previous, actually. The name keeps coming from the gentleman in the audience, or else it's the young lady in the front. Whose voice is broken. I can't give you any for that. Enrico Caruso is the answer. Denis, this is the composer who was originally asked to write the musical score for Annie Get Your Gun, but he died before he could complete it, and Irving Berlin took over the job, as we all now know. Who was the original composer intended for Annie Get Your Gun?
Was it Jerome Kern?
It was, yes. Strange, isn't it, to think that we could have known all the songs by Jerome Kern for Annie Get Your Gun. He died in 1946, all the scores completed. That's three marks. Ian Wallace. Somebody here for you, born in Hamburg, 1833, died in Vienna in 1897. Admired by Liszt and Schumann, himself an admirer of Wagner. He wrote four symphonies, but no opera. He was a confirmed bachelor, and I'm told that he was very keen on black coffee and strong black cigars. Who was he?
It couldn't be Brahms.
Do you want me to put you out of your misery?
And I'll go for Brahms.
You are right, it was Brahms. Yes. Three marks. Frank, this isn't so much a question as a synopsis for a novel. Still, I'll read it. A musician heard a fascinating tune on the radio, but afterwards couldn't trace it. On a beach in Carinthia, he heard a man whistling it, so he asked him what it was. The stranger offered to go back to the hotel and play it to him on the piano. As a result, the two men went into partnership and delighted music lovers throughout the world as a result. Can you give me their surnames?
The absolutely accurate answer to your question, for which I'm entitled 3 marks, is no.
Can you give me their surnames? Yes. Have a shot. No?
What do they do? Give me a clue. Go on. Come on.
They play Strauss medleys on the piano.
Together.
And pinball snowflakes.
Together.
And, yes.
One of them goes... Bum, 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 bum.
That's right. Fiddle, fiddle, fiddle. Yes. It's
Rabbit and Landau.
Yes, for 2 marks out of 3. Two out of 3, and they certainly do play together. They're uncanny. In the next round, Graham Dalley will start a tune. We ask you to finish it, for good and all. And first, David Franklin.
Oh, what a surprise. Come on, who's got the next line? Da 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 da. Two lovely black eyes.
Yeah, 3 lines, you got 2 of them, 2 marks. Fair enough, isn't it? Only for telling a man he was wrong with a little missing line. Here's a song for Denis Norden.
This is one of the tweeest songs ever written. Can I call on Frank? Would you help me with the echo? Twee for two.
Little Sir Echo, how do you do? Hello.
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 Little Sir Echo, I'm very blue. Hello.
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 You're a nice little fellow, I tell by your voice. But I wish you were far.
For improving on the original.
Yes, how many do I get?
Now, Ian Wallace. French for a try on. I really think Ian too, don't you, for not knowing a single word in the entire of the piece. Come back to Erin, Mavourneen, Mavourneen.
Oh, of course,
back,
yes.
The land of thy birth, Killarney shall ring with our mirth, and so on. Yeah. Pressing on to a song for and from Frank Muir.
All the nice girls love a talk for the something about a sailor, because you know what sailors are. Bright and breezy, free and easy, their life is pride and joy. Now we're off to sea again. Ship ahoy!
Ship ahoy!
Ship ahoy! Ship ahoy.
Some terrible line nobody knows in the middle of that.
Well, you know what sailors are, was the exact word. Yes.
No, it's the...
Falls
off to sea again.
Yes.
What is that word?
Falls in love with Kate and Jane.
I'm reliable.
My partner informed. Had it. He sang it.
Yeah. Well, it's two to the audience, one to Frank, so it's a three. That, I'm afraid, brings us to the end of this edition of My Music. But I see that David Franklin and Frank Muir have won by one mark.
Taking part in My Music were David Franklin, Frank Muir, Denis Norden and Ian Wallace. Graham Dalley was at the keyboard and the chairman was Steve Ray. The questions were compiled by Edward J. Mason and the program was produced in London by Tony Schreier. The BBC presents My Music, a musical panel game devised by Edward J. Mason and Tony Schreier. And here's Steve Race to introduce the team.
As usual, My Music is played between David Franklin and Frank Muir versus, on the other side, Ian Wallace and Denis Norden. I ask musical questions, they answer them. It's as simple as that. I have no partiality at all, other than for Ian Wallace. We begin with some of those "Where have I heard it before?" questions. One mark for the title and one for the composer. And we begin, as ever, with David Franklin. Everybody knows it. But
the awful part of it is that these excerpts on gramophone records are selected with diabolical ingenuity just when they're linking into the bit that I know.
The tune. Yes. Then comes the tune, isn't it?
No, that's just the lead-in.
Shall I tell you what it's not? It's not The Sad Husbands of Slough.
It's what?
It's not The Sad Husbands of Slough.
For many words of wisdom.
Well done.
It's Nikolai, is it?
Yes.
Indeed. Yes. Do I get a mark for that?
Yes, you do. 1.5.
Thank you.
You may well say thank you.
Oh, benevolent race.
Yes. 1.5 out of 2 there. Denis Norden, a piece of very Snoopy music for you.
Believe that I once danced to this.
when I was in the rap in a service show with a blonde wig and tights in which I was ashamed to stand up and scared to sit down. It's the Sylvia Ballet by Delib, or it might be the Delib Ballet by Sylvia.
It's the Ballet best by Sylvia Delib. Yes. Do you know what it is, the piece from Sylvia Ballet?
I only know it's the Sylvia Ballet, but you get the minimum from me, Steve. Well,
I love to see Dennis dancing pizzicato.
Yeah.
That's the bit I'm looking for. The pizzicato from Sylvia Ballet by Leo Delib. Yes, you get your 2 marks anyway, Dennis. And Ian Wallace's turn. This in tights.
Yeah, that rather matches my mood at the moment. That really stopped where I might conceivably have known what it was.
Well, I gave David a hint. Shall I give you a hint?
Oh, yes, please.
He came from Finland.
Oh, well, then it must be Sibelius.
Yes. And the piece?
It is Finlandia.
Yes, I think one would be all. One and a half.
Same as my colleague and friend. Yes,
yes. I'm feeling expensive tonight. One and a half.
Can I just have the clue and never bother about the music?
For one and a half, but try the music, Frank.
It's a polka.
It's a polka rhythm. It's not called a polka, though.
No. It isn't. No. Possibly by one of the Strauss family.
Possibly, but actually not.
No. Well, I'm getting tepid. It's very exciting, isn't it, really?
You're freezing at the moment, and I can't think of a clue for it. That's a terrible thing.
Well, the name would be a help. I can't guarantee to pronounce it accurately.
Shall I give you the third word?
Yes.
Overture. you're not going to know, Frank, are you? I remember Borominovich and his harmonica rascals playing this. It's by Suppe, Franz von Suppe. You know, David? No.
Suppe.
Morning, noon, and night?
No.
Suppe was a light cavalry overture.
Yes, that's right.
This
is about a woman, this one. There's a hint for you.
La mer.
Why women and song?
No, I can't go on forever with this. Peak Dame Overture by Suppe.
What?
Peak Dame. Peak means woman in French. Peak Dame Overture. No marks, I'm afraid. For Frank. And on to the next round. Irving Berlin said, as you will recall, the song is ended, but the melody lingers on. Very often the words linger on, too. This round concerns the lyrics of old ballads, old songs. David Franklin. Where was I sitting one day when I was tired and uncomfortable, and what were my fingers doing?
God give me self-discipline. Was I sitting one day in the organ loft?
Yes. Well,
and I was really ill at ease.
And yes, and your fingers, my fingers.
And my fingers were
wandering
over the keyboards.
Yeah. You've never sung it, have you?
No, I've never sung
they
it.
Were wandering.
But it is the lost chord.
Yes, that. Oh, you get 2 marks there. Your fingers are wandering idly, as a matter of fact, over the noisy keys. Yes, 2 marks there.
John L. Sullivan.
Well, the words by Anne Adelaide Proctor, who's counting. Dennis, who hasn't been kissed for almost half a century?
Oh, 40 years, do you?
Yes, that'll be nasty.
Mademoiselle from Armentier.
Yes, he hasn't been kissed for 40 years. 2 marks, I was going to say 20 marks. 2 marks for that. Ian, a line, Ian, in an old ballad says, sailor beware, sailor take care. Why should he take care?
Because many brave hearts are asleep in the deep.
Yes. And because danger is near, indeed. Yes, for 2 marks there.
Thank you.
Frank, at night, dear heart, for whom do I pine?
Look for the flower of my heart.
Yes.
Sweet Adeline.
Sweet Adeline.
All right, for 2 marks. Night, dear heart, for you I pine. Next round. Some Noel Coward and Ivan Avello tunes. You'll hear part of the song, but not the title line. I want the name of the song, please, and the name of the show. Dave Fenton. Title line.
I'll follow my secret heart
I'll follow my secret tart.
From which musical?
Bittersweet.
No,
not Bittersweet. That was a
little slip of the tongue.
Would you like to have a little chat between you? Have a chat, please.
What? Oh, conversation piece.
Sometimes you won't need like tech help, will you?
Well, so subtly wrapped up.
Yeah. One and a half.
Well, that
one. Yes. Ooh,
nice.
Yes.
Roam through my silent thoughts again, making a paradise here in my heart. Oh, fate may hold us far apart, she will turn up darkness.
Dennis has that smug look.
Yeah. The one I always think of, the title of it, is being shined through my dreams and once again. Like one more time. It's Ivan Avella. I think it's Glamorous Nights.
For two marks, yes, very good. Ian, your turn. The title of the song and the show.
It's that absolute, tremendously exaggerated claim that anybody could possibly make. I can give you the starlight. Is that right?
Well, there is a more exaggerated claim, like someday my heart will awake, for instance. If you will dress up these titles, you know. Well, it is someday my heart will awake, I'm afraid. The show?
My friend here thinks it might be King's Rhapsody.
Your friend has got you one mark out of two. Yes. King's Rhapsody by Ivan Avella. The singer was Vanessa Lee. And now we turn to Frank Muir.
So the pipes that supply the bathroom burst, and the lavatory makes you fear the worst. It was used by Charles the First, quite informally, and later by George the Fourth, on the journey home.
Who was singing it?
Dick Bentley,
yes, that's right.
Yeah. Well, it's by Noel Coward, it's the Stately Homes of England.
Yes, from which
we proudly represent. We only keep them up for Americans to rent. You interjected a question then.
I did, yes, I tried. The name of the show that it came from.
That's a good one.
From which it came.
Yes, it was a review, wasn't it?
More of an operette, really.
Operette?
Yes.
Very good, Mr. One down. Operette.
Should we give him one and a half? I think. Yeah. I don't really care. Let's have a look at the score. Ah, that's interesting. At the moment, Ian Wallace and Denis Norden lead by 2 marks. Now we come to opera. And David's usually rather strong on this. David, in which opera are the parts of the hero and the heroine sung respectively by a mezzo-soprano and a soprano?
Oh, Hansel and Gretel, rather Hansel and Gretel.
Yes, that's right.
By Engelbert Humperdinck the First.
Yes, and you get 3 marks for that piece of information. Denis, in which opera, by which composer, does the hero sing goodbye to a swan?
Can I sing it?
Don't say Mother Goose.
He sings, Swanee, how I love you.
Yeah, it gave you time to think.
It's that barber's couple, Low and Grin, by Wagner.
Yes, you get one mark for Low, one for Grimm, and one for Wagner. So, total 3 marks. I was sure you were going to say Mother Goose, that's one. Ian, in which opera by which composer does the heroine, whose name is the title, sing a song that says, I walk on all the streets?
Oh, can't be Venetian.
I walk on all the streets.
Yes. Da 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 da. She sings. She sings it in French too. That's another hit. I'm giving you all these hints because it's rather difficult on this.
And she says, I have never walked on this street before.
Or the street where you live.
Yeah. It's French. She wore her roux with a difference.
But is this an opera by a French composer?
Yes, it's in French by a French composer. Wrote a famous elegy. I can't give you any more hints, really.
Wrote a famous elegy?
Yes. There's a gentleman in the front row is wearing the same expression that Denis wears when he knows the answer. I think he knows the answer to this one.
What about Mr. Massenet?
Yes, you're getting very hot indeed.
And Manon Lescaut.
Playing. Manon.
Manon, well, it was the same person. And that was
Virginia. Yes, but different opera.
A different opera, yes.
Leave us face it, yes. Shall we give him 2 out of 3, audience?
Can we give me 3 out of 3, audience?
No, I think two is ample. Frank, who composed Lucia de Lammermoor and on whose novel was it based?
It's based on Walter Scott, isn't it?
Yes. Do you know the title of the Scott novel?
Yes, the trouble is we're calling it. Hang on a second. May I have a conference?
Yeah, of course.
Yes, large
have a conversation piece.
Don
who?
Donny Fetty. I don't know where he's the composer.
Well, Don wrote the words. Fetty wrote the
words. Isn't it the Heart of Midlothian?
No, it's easier than that. Lucia de Lammermoor is the opera.
The Bride of Lammermoor.
The Bride of Lammermoor.
Muir.
Oh, I think that's worth. I think that's worth 3, don't you? Yeah. Between you. Yes, that's worth 3.
Coy, but efficient.
Now for some tunes that you'll probably remember when you hear the music, but I also want the title of the film in each case. So it's the tune title, the film title, David. David, I salute you.
It was the wedding of the painted doll.
Yes.
By Mr. Stevens, presumably.
Name of the film?
Broadway Melody?
Yes, the first Broadway Melody, yes. 2 marks, very good.
It's all very well for you to laugh. That was the last film I saw.
Denis Norden, your turn. That was our leader, Max Jaffa.
That's a Rita Hayworth film, that was, isn't it? Do you remember, just after the war? The Second War. I don't know, it wasn't your... Was it You Were Never Lovelier?
It was indeed, yes. With Fred Astaire, surely. Yes. Dearly Beloved. 2 marks there,
yes.
Ian Wallace.
Lovely song. Mm.
High Society.
Yes, the name of the song. For the mark.
Samantha. Mm.
I Love You, Samantha. I mean, the full name.
Yes.
2 marks. 2 marks.
We're running over a bit, so I thought I'd shorten it down.
I Love You, Sam.
Now it's the turn of my huckleberry friend, Frank Muir.
Is
wasn't Max Jaffa playing it.
it's called Moon River.
Yes.
And a friend of mine, Richard Waring, a comedy writer, always cries when he hears it. Wherever he is at the time. Lovely song.
Lovely song.
I rather think this has been in two films.
Hmm. One called My Music.
Yeah. Wasn't it originally in State Fair? Or am I thinking of something else? It was in Breakfast in Tiffany's.
Yes, I don't know. I don't think it can have been in State Fair because the music for that was by Richard Rogers and this is by Henry Mancini.
We could have slipped it in.
Mancini. Anyway, I'm going to favour you with two marks. General musical questions, David. Which opera composer, who incidentally gave his name to a steak, wrote practically nothing for the last 40 years of his life, and how was it that he died at the age of 19?
Hamburger.
Extraordinary question.
It does make sense, though.
Was it Rossini?
Yes.
Obviously, he must have been born on leap year.
That's right. Born on leap day 1792. Very good. Denis, this is more recent. What happened at the Prince's Theatre, Pocatello, Idaho, USA?
I wasn't born in a trunk, but Judy Garland was born in a trunk. In A Star Is Born.
Yes, she sang, didn't she? Prince's Theatre, Pocatello, Idaho, in a handbag. Ian, who wrote the words of The Star Spangled Banner, and where did he write them?
Well, the second part of the question is purely academic if you don't know the answer to the first. Well, it can't have been George Washington.
No.
And if it had been, he'd have probably written it at the White House.
If you're going to start guessing, we'll take a lease on the studio.
I'm going to say I haven't the slightest idea.
I think I'm afraid I can't give you any marks. The answer is interesting, but nobody knows it. Francis Scott Key wrote the words of the Star Spangled Banner, and the point is that he wrote them while a prisoner aboard a British warship off Port McHenry, Baltimore. In 1814, so the American National Anthem was written, in a sense, on British soil. Frank, what would you do with a Granadina?
Well, a grenadine is a pomegranate in Spanish. So, pomegranate, I'd probably stick it out with it. So, dinner is pomegranates. Am I warm?
Well, that's what you do in a fruit quiz. What would you do in a music quiz?
Play it, dance it, kick it.
You said it.
Beat it, scrape it.
Stop, you go no further, gentlemen.
It's a dance.
Yes, you dance it. It is, in fact, a kind of fandango originating from Granada. I'm reading this, in southern Spain. Just as a malagueño or malagueña is a kind of fandango originating from Malaga. Now for a round of popular songs, started off by Graham Dalley and completed, we hope, by our contestants in the blaze of glory and three marks. First of all, David Franklin.
Again, John Peel at the break of day with his hounds and his fox in the moor.
Not necessarily in
the horn behind,
had trouble with his horn that morning.
I don't think you're a hunting man, Dave.
No, well, I sang it.
Well, you get two out of three because the tune was, as ever, faultless, but it should have been Duke N. John Peel when he's far, far away with his hounds and his horn in the morning.
Well, that is a corrupt version. I'm fortunate enough to have the original manuscript.
Yeah. But I am corrupt, so I'm giving you two out of three. And some singing from Dennis.
Trinity Church, I met me do. Now we live in a top back room. They sang it, hamster down, sit down for plenty. I thought that she was sweet and 20. That's what she did for me.
You've gone back to the start again. Yeah. Now we live in a top back room. It's up to my eyes in debt for renting. That's what she'd done for me. That's 2.5 out of three. Audience. Yeah. We usually get some rather lovely singing. I think we will now from Ian Wallace.
Mm-hmm. sea to sky, bearing the one that's born to be king over the sea to sky. And I run out of words after that because this is a tenor song. but I know that it's the truth.
I think, yes, you nearly got the words right. To get your third mark complete, Ian, can you tell me the first word of the first line?
Speed
Bonnie Boat. Yes, good enough. That's the three marks, certainly, isn't it? And we move on to some singing now from Frank.
Away, and I must stay. What'll I do? What'll I do when you... How much more do you want to see now?
Actually, Frank, I'm waiting for just one line with the right words.
Dreamer. What can I do with just a photograph to tell my troubles to you?
When I'm alone, yes. Well, that's very good. That's just
what I do with just a photograph to tell my troubles to you. What do I do with you?
May I say, Frank?
No, you mustn't. No. What will I do?
Okay, now. Now, I was just thinking how nice your face would look with a megaphone. I think that's three marks. I don't know why, but I think it's three marks. And I'm therefore going to announce that brings us to the end, I'm afraid, of this edition of My Music, in which Ian Wallace and Denis Norden beat David Franklin and Frank Muir by half a mark.
Taking part in My Music were David Franklin, Frank Muir, Denis Norden, and Ian Wallace. Graham Dalley was at the keyboard, and the chairman was Steve Ray. The questions were compiled by Edward J. Mason, and the program was produced in London by Tony Schreier. The BBC presents My Music, a musical panel game devised by Edward J. Mason and Tony Schreier. And here's Steve Race to introduce the team.
Hello again. On my right are Denis Norden and Ian Wallace. On my left are Frank Muir and David Franklin. I'm sure you can picture the scene. I'm also sure you know the answers to the musical questions I'll be asking them, beginning with these familiar instrumental themes. One mark for the title, another mark for the composer, David Franklin.
Is this McDowell?
Yes.
And it's, there's a rose somewhere in the title.
Yes, that's right. You're going to get this.
It's not only a rose.
No,
it's not. Because that's something different.
It's a kind of rose.
What?
It's a kind of rose. An untamed one.
A what?
An untamed rose.
Yes, of course. A fierce rose. No, silly me, I knew it all the time. A wild rose.
Yes.
A no. To a wild rose.
I prefer to a fierce rose myself, but he called it
a dog rose.
Edward McDowell called it to a wild rose. Yes, jolly good, and you get two marks. Denis Norden, your turn.
Is that one again? I was on a natter with Ian. Bach, staccato and fugue.
Well, he wrote a lot of them. Which one is this?
You get this answer, Steve. As far as I'm concerned, he wrote one, which is the one that I know. Little voice in my ear said, try number four.
Oh, well, it doesn't have a number. It has a name, as well, a key, as far as I'm concerned. Well, I'll tell you what, I'll settle for whether it was the toccata or the fugue.
That bit was the toccata.
Yes, toccata and fugue, yes. In D minor. By, did you say?
I said Bach.
Bach, yes, and you meant Bach. Yeah, two marks, yeah. J.S. Bach. Ian, your turn.
I don't think it's Tchaikovsky, and he's not moved a muscle.
this is me you're talking
yes.
about.
Yes,
I thought you meant Tchaikovsky for a minute. No, I can but give you no marks, I'm afraid, and the mere consolation is that I don't think any of us would have known this one. I didn't. It's the March from the Prophet by Meyerbeer, Giacomo Meyerbeer. I'm going to run an unofficial quiz and ask if anybody in the audience knew what that was. No. Right, fair enough. We move on to one that absolutely everybody knows, except perhaps Frank Muir.
Well, of course, we all know this. It's the minuet in G. I need no clues on this. Minuet in G, comma. What was the name you said? Ludwig von Beethoven, a foreign gentleman.
Yes. Yes, well, anyway, Beethoven, you're right for two marks. Minuet in G. Mm-hmm. Very good.
Give us a hard one next time.
All right. Says he, glancing ahead, you shall have a harder one next time. Songs that tell a story, to test your knowledge of these old favourites. Can you tell me, David, Frankie shot Johnny, rooty toot toot, because she found him making love to someone else. Who was the other woman? You may have to run through the song a couple of times. He's making love to...
Admiral Bly. Millie Bly.
What was the question?
the other name in the triangle of Frankie and Johnny and...
Frankie and Johnny were lovers.
Ah, yes. Then Frankie had done her wrong by having a close friend, another lady.
I don't know what I'd do without Frank to interpret.
And there was a bit of a brouhaha went on, you see. And he shot this Admiral Bly's daughter, Nellie.
Tell me when you'd like the marks, and we'll move on. Would you like the marks now, David?
Try it on, sir.
All right. I'm advised. I am advised to tell you that it was Admiral Bly.
You think it was Nellie Bly?
Yes.
Is this a quick-fire game, this is? Yes, you're right. Yes, it was making love to Nellie Bly. Well,
my trouble is that Mummy would never let me sing that at home, so I never got to her name.
While we're on names, Dennis, who went to Widdicombe Fair and on whose what?
Oh, Lord, it's this crew, isn't it? Yeah. John Brewer, Bill Stewart, Peter Gurney, Daniel Whidden, Harry Ork.
Harry Ork's my favourite, because whenever anybody gets there, they always smile, because they never got to the end. I've got a picture of Harry Ork. I rather like him. And Uncle Tom Cobbley. And what was the rest of the question?
I've forgotten. On whose what did they go to Widdicombe Fair?
Well, I don't know. They asked for a loan of a horse, whether they actually went on it, whether they actually got it. Did they have... This is one of the great unsolved questions, like, you know, why doesn't Bill Bailey come home?
Ask Millie Bly.
Actually,
I know why Bill Bailey doesn't come home. It's because his wife doesn't use the right soap powder. In fact, if you listen to the lyric, she says, "I'll do your wash in honey."
Stickler for accuracy that I am because of the letters one gets. They borrowed Tom Pierce's grey mare, and the name you forgot was Peter Davy, I think. You've got all the others.
Oh, Peter Davy, yes. Mm. I must apologise to Mrs. Davy and any other Davy. All at number 29.
Two marks, anyway, there. And Ian. Ian, in which song does the lady sing, "The moment I saw him, I fell"? Where was she and where did she get off?
Oh, I thought it was "The moment I saw you, I knew from the start." That's not the one.
"The moment I saw him, I fell."
She was on the trolley.
Yes, that's right.
And it went clang several times.
Where did she get off?
"I stayed on with him, and it was grand just to stand with him."
Lovely.
To the end of the line.
Yes, at the terminus.
To the end of the line. Yes. Yes, to the end of the line. Two marks in the trolley song. Frank, don't tell me the lights are shining any place but there. Where, and strictly speaking, when?
St. Louis.
Yes. Because of the song?
Because of the song, "Meet Me in St. Louis," Louis, yes, which was sung by Judy Garland to an actor representing a character whose Christian name, presumably, was Louis. Mm-hmm. It was "Meet Me in St. Louis, Louis," and it was the St. Louis World Fair.
Of which year?
Yes. Well,
19
round about 1904.
I'm sorry, one of my fingers got stuck, actually. Yes, 1904. I'm told it should be pronounced St. Louis, but never mind. And that's two marks there. Gentlemen, remember the bits of mood music we've played you from time to time. This is specially atmospheric music written by composers to match certain types of plot or situation in films or television plays, something like that. Let's see how near you can get to the kind of story and to the composer's actual title. David.
There were these chaps who went up the north of Scotland to climb a thing. They took the precaution of getting television cameras halfway up before they started. And the producer didn't like the first take. They had to go down and do it all over again. And in the middle, it got cold and dark. And they were freezing to death as they clung to the face of this thing all night. Title? Frozen to the Marrow.
Yeah, well, three marks. Three marks, because I always give three on this round. Three marks. When you talked about them sort of stuck on the edge of the mountain, there was little bits of wind eddying round. It was that kind of thing, wasn't it? Yeah. The composer called it Catherine Wheel. But it was sort of spinning round like that.
Can't understand it.
You wouldn't have called it that if you were me, would you?
Did you write that?
Yes, I did, actually.
I can only say, Steve, my face is terribly red. I am embarrassed.
Not at all. I liked your title better than mine. Anyway, three bars.
Thanks, Steve.
And I didn't write any of the others, so let's carry on. Here's Dennis's turn.
¶¶
kind of music they play in those, sort of Walt Disney sort of anthropomorphic sort of whimsical films about nature's wonderland, and they say, and life is not all tragedy here in the great unspoken heart of Africa, because as we see these elephants bathing, we notice how Mama Elephant gives her young squirt a big squirt. It's bath time for young Jumbo.
Ah, yes, that's 3 marks without any question. Wolf Troyson wrote it. It's called The Cat and the Hippo. Ian, your turn.
That's the sort of music that you hear in the cinema while they are showing those coloured advertisements, the ones that haven't been able to afford a soundtrack. And you see this woman, very nicely dressed, walking into this car showroom and going up to a very nice car, and the chap comes forward and he opens the door and she looks in and she goes... at some feature of the car. You don't know what it is, but you see... And then you see her sort of nodding and smiling, and he's made out the order, and then it changes, and you see a bit with sort of people punting down a river, and they just show you a sort of quivering water lily for a moment. It's all very nice. Very sweet and charming and means absolutely nothing. The title... Ooh. Village Frolic.
Not for the first time, I think you've done better than the composer. That's 3 marks. The composer, James Stevens, called it The Equilibrist.
Did he?
Quite know why. It was in five time, which is rather unusual. Anyway, some music now for Frank Muir.
Nature, I think, gentlemen. Nature's involved in this. Probably continental. Czech? Polish, do you think? And there's a little boy in the film. And the seasons are changing. And in this, it's dawn. He's got up early before his parents. And it's still a bit dark. And you can see the elm trees against the sky. And there's a windmill turning. And... oh, they're doing their nut with shots into the rising sun. And little bits of Nouvelle Vague. And it's called Piccadillo.
But of course...
I'm bound to be near in one of them.
Piccadillo. Well, now that's extraordinary. It isn't called Piccadillo, of course. No. You know, I have to knock off the mark, Frank, because I do so agree with your, you know, reading of the music, but you didn't notice the biggest clue of all there, a reharmonized version of the wedding march, which is in there definitely as a clue. Da 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 da.
You said it was full of nature.
Two out of three. Van Phillips wrote it and called it. Van Phillips called it Engagement Ring.
Good luck. What's he doing now?
Well, he's thinking of changing it to Piccadillo. A round of general musical knowledge questions. David, what's a mirror fugue?
A mirror fugue is a fugue which is built up on a subject which in which the first half of the theme is balanced by the second half of the theme, which is the first half played backwards.
You could really call it, in a loose way, you could call it a kind of musical palindrome, really, couldn't you?
I would have done, except
it sort of points both ways.
It's rather dull to have done it like that.
Yeah. It can be a fugue which, when played from the end to the beginning, sounds the same as when played from the beginning to the end. There are slight variants on it, but you certainly get 2 marks. Wish I could give you 20 for that. Mm-hmm. Dennis, we'll try you on a jazz question. We don't have much really about jazz in this series. This is to do with bands. What has Count Basie got that Duke Ellington hasn't got? And what's the name of the man responsible?
Oh, Lord, yeah.
To do with bands, I said.
Yeah, I was going to say, Count Basie's got LPs with Tony Bennett and Sarah Vaughan and Frank Sinatra. He's got an instrument in his band.
That's right.
That... A guitar.
Yes. Which of them has a guitar?
Count Basie.
Yes, and do you know who plays it?
No.
No. Jolly good for 1 mark, Freddie Green. Very much part of the Count Basie sound. 1 mark.
Freddie, yeah. Well, it was Sammy, you know.
Yes. Ian, here's one of these fascinating ones. Of which song, first heard in a masque called Alfred in 1740, did Wagner say, "The first 8 notes express the whole character of the British nation," unquote. And for a second mark, who composed the tune? Wagner said, "The first 8 notes express the whole character of the British nation."
Well, actually, he said, "Die erste acht." I mean, that's as far as I could go with that.
At the end, he said, "Ungefote."
Well, I suppose it might have been the national anthem.
No, but it's not far off. You know, it's obviously one of those, isn't it?
Yes, it must be. Let's try Rule Britannia.
Yes, that's a mark. Very good. Do you know who composed Rule Britannia?
It's one of these names like Jeremiah Stamp.
It isn't very much like Jeremiah Stamp. More like Thomas Arne.
Yes, well.
I tell you what, I will give you your other notes if you can tell me quickly. He said the first 8 notes express the whole character. Which 8 notes did he mean? Quickly.
Dum, bum, bum, bum.
No.
Dum, 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 da, 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 dee, bum, 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 da, da, dee.
1.5 marks out of sheer generosity.
Suddenly it's the last night of the plum.
Frank, if you had a French horn, how would you stop it?
In slang terms, you'd shove a bunch of 5 up its hooter.
2 marks. Can you just explain that?
Well, the French horn's muted. This is played most of the time. With a fist shoved, actually not down it or up it, because it's sort of horizontal at the time.
Along
the
horn.
Along it. Yes. Within it.
That is how you stop a French horn. Quite right for 2 marks. Very good. Some quite hilariously funny films have been made purporting to tell the life stories of famous composers. I'll give you the film title. I want you to give me, please, the name of the composer and the name of the actor who played him or her. David Franklin, Rhapsody in Blue.
George Gershwin.
Yes, for one of your 2 marks. Do you know who played him?
No.
No marks, of course, for Dennis. If you do, do you know Dennis? You're the
Robert Alder.
Robert Alder, that's right. It was Robert Alder. That's 1 mark out of 2. Dennis, your turn. Song Without End.
Oh, that's Cappuccini, isn't it? And Dirk Bogarde.
Cappuccini.
I didn't ask you to name the drink. just the composer.
Was it Dirk Bogarde? Who's he looking?
Yes, Dirk Bogarde is right.
It wasn't Chopin. That was the other song. That was Song to Remember. That was hilarious. That was one. I suppose that's the next question.
No, the next but one.
Yeah. Well, that next but one was Chopin. What were we doing?
You were about to tell us the name of the composer that Dirk Bogarde played.
It was Liszt.
Liszt.
That's right.
Where did that come from?
Yes, that came welling up. Yes.
Liszt for your other mark, you know. Ian Wallace, can you please name the lyric writer in Words and Music?
Lawrence Hart, and it was Mickey Rooney.
Yes, of Rodgers and Hart. That's right, for 2 marks. Frank, A Song to Remember.
It was Cornell Wilde's The Life of Chopin.
Yes.
And
very good indeed, Frank Muir.
Mayonnaise waltz. He had a steak named after one of his waltzes.
The Minute Waltz.
Next comes a round in which knowledge gives way to sheer talent. A round of songs, popular old songs played by Graham Dalley and sung when he leaves off by our contestants. David, yours.
Down at the old Bull and Bush, ta-ra-ra-ra-ra, come and drink some port wine with me. Guess where? Down at the old Bull and Bush.
Let's all have a little sing, shall we?
Hear the little German band, da 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 da. Come and drink and do.
Do me.
Down at the old Bull and Bush, Bush, Bush.
They know as little of the words as I do.
It's no marks to them, 3 marks to you. Dennis.
Don't be a serpent, Chinello.
Son, you dig them back.
We do for you.
I used to see us walking on the front at home with those wide trousers on. This is Laugh Clown Laugh. All dressed up, look, you know.
Frank, the audience
Frank and I
won't be in trouble.
Somebody's saying, look at him, he's all dressed up like Laugh Clown Laugh.
Any idea of the words?
Or the tune? Even though you're only make-believing, yes. Laugh Clown. No, I've really got no idea. It's shrouded in mists of memory, this.
I think one of you is for knowing what it's called. One mark there. And on to Ian Wallace.
Take it down a bit.
Words.
It's Irish.
Sparky Larley's lakes and something fat.
No, can't be felt.
Sparky Larley.
If there is going to be a life here. Yes, you didn't do very well with the words. I think two is enough.
Well, I think
like Alani Lake and Fells, Emerald Isles and Winding Bays, Mountain Paths and Woodland Dells, Memory Ever Fondly Strays, and so on. Nice words.
Very.
Frank Muir, your turn.
The Campbells are coming. Hooray, hooray. Sung by the Watchers on Glen Coe. The Campbell, and it goes on. The Campbells are coming. Hooray, hooray.
Oh, ho, oh, ho.
Hoorah, hoorah.
Oh, ho, oh, ho.
What, oh, ho, 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 ho. I'll allow you that.
Can you get your marks by telling me what the Campbell, where the Campbells are coming to? The Campbells are coming to Bonnie.
Oh, are they?
Mary of Argyle.
Always.
To Bunny Mary of Argyle.
It's almost invariably Bonnie Dundee, but I bet it isn't.
I do try on this programme, but I fail. No, well...
It wasn't Glen Coe, I know that.
No. Bonnie Lochleven, the Campbells are coming.
Oh, near.
I looked down to Bonnie Lochleven and saw three Bonnie Pipers play. A mark. And there we must end, I'm afraid. And at the end of this edition of My Music, let's have a look. David Franklin and Frank Muir win by 1.5 marks.
Taking part in My Music were David Franklin, Frank Muir, Denis Norden and Ian Wallace. Graham Dalley was at the keyboard and the chairman was Steve Ray. The questions were compiled by Edward J. Mason and the program was produced in London by Tony Schreier. Thank you. The BBC presents My Music. A musical panel game devised by Edward J. Mason and Tony Schreier. And here's Steve Race to introduce the team.
On my right, Ian Wallace and Denis Norden. On my left, David Franklin and Frank Muir. Beside me, a charming scorer. In front of me, lots of musical questions and a highly intellectual audience. More applause? No, never mind. Some classical themes, first of all, round one. You'll recognise them at once, gentlemen. Two marks, if you do, and an extra mark for the name of the composer. And we begin, as always, with David Franklin. And for you, David, a gay gallop. It's a good start to the show, David. You know, it's a
very good start. Would you care to give me a trifling little clue, like, for instance, the first six letters of the composer's name?
I'll give you the first four letters of the title. How would that be a help, all right? L-A-B-O.
L-A-B-O?
Yes.
Laboratory.
L-A-B-O?
L-A-B-O, yes.
Would I you ask to give for the first six.
Well, I'll have to ask the other side. Shall I give him the first six?
Well, I think I know it, so I don't know what to say.
I'll give you the first six for half marks or something, yes. L-A-B-O-U-T.
Layabout.
I'm going to come in here and say you don't know it, do you?
I haven't the faintest idea.
No, La Boutique Fantasque.
Oh.
I didn't say where the spaces between the words came.
Oh.
For one mark, who wrote it? Do you know, for one mark?
La Boutique Fantasque, Frenchman.
No. It was Rossini, an Italian gentleman. No marks, I'm afraid. See if Denis Norden can get us off the ground with his.
This isn't a boutique at all. This is the... They always give the easier ones to the ignoramuses on the team. This is the Unfurnished Symphony by Schubert.
In one flat, yes. Yeah. Yes, Schubert, Unfurnished Symphony number, you happen to know?
No, but I should say the money that you dock them for giving them four letters. You can take
don't
that
worry.
Much off my...
No, don't worry, you've got three marks.
We know why it was unfinished. It was to leave room for the commercial.
Three marks. Sue Dennis Norden, anyway, for that. Oh, who wrote it? Did you say?
I said Schubert.
You said
yeah.
Schubert, yes. I nearly said it myself. Yes, three marks there. And Ian Wallace's turn.
Mr. Verdi is a composer, and I would say it was one of the entr'actes from the opera La Traviata.
Not so much entr'actes as pre-act.
Prelude.
All right, yes, for three marks. From the Prelude to La Traviata by Verdi, and Frank Muir's turn.
Supposed to know this sort of thing. I was so sorry. But
do you know what it is?
What?
That music.
Yes, well, no. No, I don't really know. It's Tchaikovsky version.
Yes, that's right.
Yeah. And it's very lovely. And it goes... It's a Tchaikovsky piece which goes... Yes.
Well, you get one mark for reviewing it so well.
Ah, yes.
Oh.
It's a symphony that he wrote, and he turned to his wife and said, "What do you think?" And she said, "Pathetic." Ever since.
Yes, 3 marks to you, which is more than Tchaikovsky's wife gave him. a round of quick opera composers. Well, no, a quick...
But one-act opera. Yeah.
Written in 2 days.
Yes, come think of it, a quick round of opera composers.
Instant opera.
I give you the name of the opera, and for 2 marks, will you please give me the name of its composer? David Franklin, La Gioconda.
It's, Ponchielli.
Hmm. Yes, that's right.
Is that quick enough?
Yes, very good. Yes, 2 marks for Ponchielli. Denis Norden, Oberon.
Now, we slow down a bit now. Oberon, you write it. The aria is Come Over on the Sunny Side. it's written by... What?
Written by Ian Wallace.
Deduct 2 marks for bad handwriting, but it's Weber.
Yes. Ian's opinion of your musical knowledge is so terrible, he writes them down phonetically now.
He writes them down before the music starts.
It's by V-A-Y-B-A. That's right, Weber. Otherwise known as Weber.
V-A-B-E-R.
And Ian, it's your turn and you're on your own. Who wrote Lakme?
It wasn't Delibes.
Wasn't it?
No.
Yes. Oh, you're very quick. Yes, it was. Yes, you were right the second time. It was Delibes, not it wasn't. 2 marks for Delibes and Frank Muir, Lucrezia Borgia.
Oh, yes. Some poison or poisons unknown.
Was she?
Donna?
Donna Kelly?
No, he put it down phonetically for
it. Steve will know. Donny Chetty. Does that strike a chord at all?
Give or take it. Yes, Donny Chetty. The score, incidentally, Ian Wallace and Denis Norden lead at the moment by 2 marks. But that's only for the moment. Next round, song lyrics. David Franklin, if I could get you all to myself alone, where would I like to be?
Oh, on a slow boat to China.
Yes, that's right. 2 marks, yes. Denis, oh, Fred, tell them to stop. What was upsetting who? Or whom?
That was the cry of Mariah. Yes. But the more she said woe, the more they would go, and the swing went a little bit high.
Yes. Fragonard painted it.
Yes. Yes. Fred Fragonard. Yes. 2 marks, then. Ian, rather more complicated one for you, of course. In Surrey with a Fringe on Top, what can you tell me, please, about the wheels, the upholstery, the dashboard and the curtains?
Oh. Isinglass curtains.
Yes.
The upholstery.
I've got a good mind to get the audience to sing it to you. Come here, ready? The wheels are...
My leather.
Thank you. 2 marks to Ian Wallace.
Thank you very much. But I did get the isinglass curtains on there. Whatever they are.
Frank, like my dreams, they fade and die. What do?
Oh, yes. Bubbles.
Yes,
because which of... I am forever. I'm forever blowing them in the air. And up they go, high, till they almost reach the sky.
Nearly reach the sky.
Yeah.
Moving on to another round. Round of people with distinctive sounds. 2 marks for identifying them. So we're back to the music, and some music for you, David.
It's
David David, give or take an umlaut. What's that?
This is an Austrian choir, is it?
No.
It's a German choir?
Yes.
Boys' choir or girls' choir?
I don't really know. It's a children's choir, as far as I'm concerned. Children.
Mixed infants.
Let's say mixed infants.
I don't know. No marks.
It's not anything. It's the Obenkirchen Children's Choir. Their famous record of A Happy Wanderer. And Obenkirchen, in answer to your next question, is 9 miles east of Minden in West Germany. Moving hastily on now to some music for Denis.
Chloe, someone calling. Hello?
Denis, one mark for the group, one for the singer.
Oh, that's tough. Spike Jones, City Slickers.
Yes.
Ah, you've nailed me on the other one.
Guess and you'll be right.
Spike Jones.
Oh, no. Second guess.
We can't be right. City Slicker because of this. I don't know.
You
no.
don't know, really. No. Red Ingle.
Red Ingle.
Yeah. Spike Jones, one mark. Red Ingle, no marks, I'm afraid. Ian Wallace, who's this?
Slap that face, slap the pill is busy, slap that face, keep the river busy, zoom, 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 misery, you got to go.
It's hardly worth wasting the time in asking you.
That's my generation, all right. Fred Astaire.
Fred Astaire, yes. Two marks for that. And Frank Stern.
Red Ingle.
I don't know his name.
I'll tell you his name, Belayev.
Yeah. Isn't it the Red Army Ensemble?
It is indeed. Yes. Kalinka, the name of the tune, Belayev the singer. It was indeed the Red Army Ensemble. Quite right for two marks. Now we go all verbal for a bit. Musical general knowledge for two marks. David, why is a promenade concert not a promenade concert? And can you enlarge upon the fact?
Yes, well, it's because it's Thursday. His father's name.
Too many people go there. They can't walk. They can't move.
Yes, that's right. They did once walk, did they?
No.
Yes.
Well, they did. not so much to say walk. It sort of shifted from one foot to the other.
They still do that sometimes at the proms, yeah. Yes, the original promenade concert.
Ah, now you're going back to the 18th century, to Vauxhall Gardens. That isn't on your bit of paper, is it?
No, I'm going back to the first half of the 19th century, during which time Vauxhall Gardens shut down, if my memory serves me correctly. The French conductors Julien and Buzard, in the first half of the 19th, introduced concerts at which people did walk around. You were saying that, in effect, weren't you, really? They
indeed
don't walk about
anymore. Indeed I was. Yes. That's my position.
Yes, and you get two marks for your position.
What about a brass band on the front at Brighton? Is that a promenade?
I suppose that would have done equally well, wouldn't it? Denis, your turn. Who composed the Frog Quartet, and why was it so called?
The only Frog Quartet I know... Compagnon de la Chanson. why is it so called? Composed by H. de Vere Tadpole. No. I don't know. Ian.
I'll take a mark off and tell you it was Haydn. Now, why is it called the Frog Quartet?
Because, according to a tipster that I have, nearly everything of his was named after an animal.
No, the chief theme in the finale has a reminiscent croaking sound. Somebody called it the Frog Quartet. Ian, which celebrated English soprano became famous on the French opera stage and then changed the spelling of her name so that Frenchmen would say it correctly?
It was Florrie Ford, who changed her name to Florrie Citroën.
I can't improve on that.
but I suspect the right answer might have been Maggie Tate.
Yes, for 2 marks.
Changed it presumably from T-A-T to T-E-Y-T-E.
That's right, Dame Maggie Tate. Frank.
See, the right answer gets nothing.
No, 2 marks.
It's a process known in France as tête-à-tête. Yes.
Oh, shut up.
I know. It's over tiredness.
Well, the shut up came from Frank Muir. Frank, it's your turn now. What do the musical initials VS stand for?
I don't know.
VS. What?
Noted for your snappy riposte.
Go back to the beginning and start again. Yeah,
your mate backed the wrong horse there. He's thinking of Da Capo. This is...
You think of what?
No. He'll tell you after the show.
Vile horse.
VS. Anybody in the audience know? Thank you very much, Volte.
Whenever I see VS, I always go back to the beginning and start again. That's why your concerts take so long. Come on, what's the clever catch answer?
Now, it means turn over quickly. If you're a pianist and you've got to get to the bottom of the page, you'd normally turn over fairly quickly. If the composer knows, or the typesetter, I suppose, or whoever the engraver knows that there's something rather difficult over the page, he puts VS, turn over quickly, because you need to see the next bit. No marks there. Next round concerns the silver screen. Tunes from films. For 2 marks, can you please name not the tune... unless they happen to be the same, but the name of the film. David, your turn.
I can do no better than give the answer that I've given on several previous occasions. It's always been right. The Birth of a Nation.
Yeah, I've got nothing to say except that you're wrong.
No marks?
No. Well, unless its subtitle was Days of Wine and Roses, was it?
Is that the name of a film?
Yes. The name of the tune, too. The name of that nice record by Pepe Jaramillo. Days of Wine and Roses, no marks, I'm afraid, to David. Dennis, here's the music for you.
Called Moore. I have an idea. It's an originally Italian song, and nobody in the audience knows it, so I can't push off over.
Shall I give you a clue? Shall I give him a clue?
Yeah.
It's a dog's life.
Lassie. You played the hell. Mondo Carne.
Yes, thank you very much. Mondo Carne. Yes. Difficult one, so we'll give you your two for that. Ian, your turn.
Yes, I knew that. My collaborator has an idea that it might be the Inn of the Sixth Happiness.
Yes, you're absolutely right. For 2 marks. Yes, the children's marching. So, Knick-Knack Paddywhack is the title I call it. Anyway, you're right, of course. The Inn of the Sixth Happiness is the film. Thanks, Dylan.
No, you don't want that bit, I know, do you? It's Que Sera Sera, and it won an Oscar for being a jolly good tune to put on the front of a film. It was so good a tune, it's obliterated any memory of the film. Doris Day connected with it.
That's right, Doris
Hard
Day.
Hard Day's Night. Was it one of those funnies?
The title's rather a serious one, as a matter of fact. It sounds to me like a I didn't see the film, but it sounds to me like a thriller from the title.
It's a Hitchcock film.
I think it might well have been, yes. James Stewart and Doris Day were in the thing. Frank Chatfield made that record. But
sorry, he got stabbed in the marketplace.
Well,
I don't think you know, Frank, do you?
No, well, que sera, sera.
I can't give you a clue without telling you too much, really. The Man Who Knew Too Much was the title of the film. Well, I tried, Frank.
It was a remake, wasn't it?
Twice.
Was it Hitchcock, The Man Who Knew Too Much?
Yes, twice.
Now a round of popular old songs played by Graham Dalley. Can you pick up where he left off, please, teams? With the words. Uh-huh. David.
Beside the seaside, I do like to be beside the sea. Oh, I do like to stroll along the pom 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 when the brass band plays tiddly on pom pom. Oh, I do like to be beside the seaside. That's enough for three.
It's enough for three marks, actually, yes, three marks. What's the title of the song, David?
I do like to be beside the seaside.
Very good, yes. No extra marks for that. I don't know this song, but I think perhaps Denis... Well, I hope Denis will.
No, I don't know it at all. It's a name. Is it a name of somebody? It's like Charlie.
Yes, it...
Oh. Arthur.
Try girls.
To take a butler.
Try some girls.
It can't be Chloe.
It's not Sally either, because they've kind of ventured in there.
I can't really help you, can I don't think.
Martha. So
gangster's girlfriend.
Molly.
Yes.
Molly. You just Molly, please put up your brolly. You're digging it right in my all together now.
Yeah, well, I'll give you a mark. I didn't know this one either. Molly, I'm so melancholy when I'm far away from you. Anyway, a mark. I think that's generous, yes. And a song from Ian Wallace.
Stand by for blasting.
By yon bonny banks and by yon bonny braes, when the sun sets.
Oh, heavens.
Up a bit, Aiden.
Where me and my true love will ever want again. By the bonny, bonny banks of Loch Lomond.
Yes, three marks.
No marks for that in Scotland.
That's it's a lovely English song, to be sure, isn't it, there? Yeah. No, lovely Scott song. This bit of singing we get from Ian is so nice. I'm going to ask you, Ian, to sing us the chorus in any key of your choice. Come on. Oh, you'll take the high road. Come on.
Oh, you'll take the high road, and I'll take the low road, and I'll be in Scotland
never fails in. After a bit of community singing, the audience will always applaud itself. Never fails.
Where were you on Molly?
When I needed you.
Let's have a mute audience for the moment now and a bit of singing from Frank Muir.
No.
Of the dance is
who's going to hold you? Ooh. Hey, who's going to hold you?
Who's going to hold you while you're tight?
I
love you. I do.
Who's the lucky boy who's going your way?
Who's going your way?
Good night.
To kiss you good night. Your door.
That's
your doorway. We're taking you home tonight. Darling, it's plain to see I'm praying.
Pleading.
Please let it be me.
Not bad, dead drunk.
For 3 marks. Well, that, I'm afraid, brings us to the end of this edition of My Music, in which Ian Wallace and Denis Norden win by 4.5 marks. Goodbye.
Taking part in My Music were David Franklin, Frank Muir, Denis Norden and Ian Wallace. Graham Dalley was at the keyboard and the chairman was Steve Ray. The questions were compiled by Edward J. Mason, and the program was produced in London by Tony Schreier. The BBC presents My Music. A musical panel game devised by Edward J. Mason and Tony Schreier. And here's Steve Race to introduce the team.
My Music, as usual, poses Frank Muir and David Franklin against Denis Norden and Ian Wallace. I shall try to keep order and the score. An audience will cheer us to the echo as the mood takes them. First, orchestral music from the world of opera or ballet. 1 mark for the title, another for the composer. First turn to David Franklin. Practically a piece of music I would take to my desert island.
Prelude to the Master Singers by Dick Wagner.
Yes, overture to the Master Singer, Richard Wagner. I got into trouble from a listener because somebody called him Dick Wagner once, but anyway, that's all in the past. 2 marks. Denis.
Well, I got Gilbert and Sullivan, and Ian was no help at all. Beyond that, so far.
I gave David some letters last week. Shall I give you the first two letters as a clue?
Yes.
I.O.
Elo Yolante.
All right, yes. So 1.5 marks, I think, out of the two. Played by the combined Fairy Aviation, Foden's BMC. A nice brass band noise.
Conducted by Harry Mortimer, 1 extra mark.
Ian, your turn. Yes, I know how it goes, too.
Dalley?
Yes. It is now. It wasn't when it was written. It is now.
Mm-hmm. And it's Schubert?
No.
Terrible gasp from the audience. Yes, indeed. One of those terrible moments.
Somebody in the audience is trying
to agree over this. It's silly. That doesn't get us the composer, does it? Although it ought to.
It gets us further than where we were.
This is one of these terrible one knows it so well ones, but I'm not going to waste any more time.
Yeah, well, they can't give any marks. It has two titles. It was originally an A major prelude for piano, but it's in its ballet hat. It's from Les Sylphides. It keeps cropping up all through Les Sylphides by Chopin.
Chopin, yes, Chopin.
Chopin.
Yes.
Well, no marks.
No,
there.
I'm sorry.
Frank Muir, your
thank turn. You.
Ah, mm-hmm. You think I'm foxed, don't you? I know what it is. It's impossible. it's an overture of some sort.
Yes.
Well, we're moving there. Don't worry, David and Sir Tempest.
I'll give you a hint, shall I?
Yes, go on.
One mark if you don't turn into gingerbread first.
Oh, it's him. Ah, it's he. Rather.
He still doesn't know.
it's Engelbert Thingamabob. Engelbert Humperdinck I.
Yes, the overture to which of his many operas?
It's Hansel and Gretel.
Yes, what else? Yes. One mark there. People are forever complaining that one can't hear the words in popular songs these days, and some, of course, aren't worth hearing. But some of the words are worth hearing in popular songs, and I'm assuming now you've been listening to them. David, according to the song, who gave her very first kiss to you?
I gave my very first kiss to
you. You haven't yet composed the right tune.
I've no idea.
She gave her very first kiss to you. That was... don't know. Laura. That was Laura, but she's only a dream.
Laura
Lomax, I'm afraid. Sorry, don't know. Laura Humperdinck. Dennis, who makes your heart a charcoal burner?
You know, they changed the word, because it was Lana Turner, like Lana Turner. Rhymed with Lana Turner. Yeah. It was Nancy with the laughing face.
Yes, two marks there. Ian, whose fragrance divine did you walk with in the wildwood?
Martyrs.
Martyrs, yes. That's right. And Frank, who is the witch of the wood? You're right for two marks. Velia, the witch of the wood. A round now concerned with identifying musical instruments. David, can you tell me, please, what is this instrument?
Quite clear. Which of these do you want identified?
The one that was not the piano. And think before you answer, because you could get this one wrong.
Oh, this is one of the occasions when I've got to turn around a bit and watch, see if he twitches.
You are expecting me to say that it's a coriandolo.
No,
he's had his sedative.
I was expecting you to say it was the oboe.
No, I knew it was the cor anglais.
Yes, you're right, cor anglais, two marks. The oboe can't play as low as that. Thank you. actually started low and went a bit higher. The last few notes could have been played on the oboe. The first few notes, as you realise, couldn't. They were played on the
not to the discerning ear.
Played beautifully there by, incidentally, by Leon Goossens. 2 marks anyway. Denis Norden, which instrument is this?
Stringed. and we think it's a lute.
Yes. How do you play a lute?
You don't suck it and blow it, mate.
What does it look like?
Well, it looks like a flute without the F.
Quiet.
It's got strings on it. It's like sort of guitar type.
Yes,
thing.
That's right. Yes, a lute. It was played by Julian Bream. Ian, two instruments. You would identify one mark for each.
An Italian conductor once used to call the aspicord. Which in fact is a relation of mine used to call the harpiscord. Which in fact is the harpsichord.
Yes,
got the one.
Yes.
And I would say the other was the flute. But I'm a bit worried about that because there was a touch of the recorder about it too.
You're watching me as well, aren't you, for signs of that nervous tick? Yes, I know. I reacted too quickly. You'd have said flute full stop if I hadn't reacted, wouldn't you? It was the recorder.
Yes.
And the harpsichord for 2 marks. Good enough. Frank, 4 instruments, 0.5 mark each.
It's for euphonia. It's for deep tubas.
Yes, that's better. You could even guess the name of one of the players, surely, couldn't you?
Tubby.
except that. It was a tuba quartet. Yes, it was from one of the Hoffman concerts, as a matter of fact. Gerald Hoffman. 2 marks there. Let's have a look at the score. Ian and Denis, at the moment, lead by 2.5 marks. Thinking of the heart, as I say, general musical knowledge questions. Mm. For 4 marks, because I think they're a bit difficult, David, what is concrete music? Or if you wish to show off, musique concrète. Concrete music.
In a word, filthy.
You'd be lucky.
I believe it is music which is made of all sorts of extraordinary instruments, not necessarily musical instruments, and I know that tape recorders and electronic devices come into it.
Yes, you get your 4 marks. I've got a worked out, succinct answer here. Various sounds first recorded and then distorted electronically and assembled into some sort of time structure. Therefore, in other words, it's recorded sound which exists only as recorded sound, not as instrumentally played music. Quite right for 4 marks. Denis, what is meant by tempo commodo?
Tempo commodo. Tempo is Italian for time, and commodo is Italian for a bedside cupboard. So bedside cupboard time would be about 3:30 in the morning.
Right?
It's Italian for 0330.
Yes.
Or, else it's a musical expression.
Yes, if you could have a second guess, what would it be?
Take your time. Well, whenever you like. Please yourself time.
Yes. Yeah. Four marks. Complete any speed comfortable and convenient to the player.
Applies to both definitions, really.
Anything that makes you comfy. Pressing on. Ian, four marks for this one. What is a baritone with an I as opposed to a baritone with a Y?
Well, I suppose that... I've seen in opera scores it's spelt with a Y, but they were rather older scores than... the ones where I saw it spelt with an I, but I imagine that one of them is a musical instrument,
yes,
and the other is a voice.
Yes, the voice between...
Bass and the voice that I know, of course, yes, is between bass and tenor,
yes,
the one in between the two.
I'm going to give you three out of four.
Well, there is also the other baritone might apply to a saxophone.
Yes, but that would still have an I. But all the same, one of you give him four out of four, just for trying, I think, you know. Shall we?
Thank you.
Good for you saying a baritone with a Y, an instrument, even though you spoiled it by saying baritone sax. An instrument resembling the viol da gamba, for which Haydn wrote quite extensively because his patron, Prince Esterházy, played it. It is now obsolete. Frank, what is a bagatelle, and who was responsible for some of the best bagatelles? What's a bagatelle?
It's a giggle, you know, a bit of something, isn't it? An unconsidered trifle.
Yes, and who was responsible for some of the best bagatelles? You don't know, actually.
Well, yeah, he'd presumably be French. Drawing a bow at a venture. Then the word bagatelle is normally French.
No, he hasn't.
You also shove a ball up a table with a rod. And it goes ping, 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 and goes into the knot. But that's...
Well, two marks for knowing out of four for knowing what a bagatelle is. Beethoven composed three sets of bagatellen for the piano, comprising
him
26 pieces. Yes, a bully for Beethoven. Right, yeah. In the following pieces of music, we haven't always chosen the most obvious bits, but for two marks, can you give me just the title of the song, David?
But what's the title?
Avalon.
Mouth it a bit louder. Oh, Avalon. Yes, it just happened.
Yes.
Thank you.
I'm going to be telling you all the time. You're looking at the audience.
Mr. You are. Words.
I travel on to Avalon, yes. Two marks there. I'm told, by the way, I didn't know this, that there was a court action between this and Puccini's Tosca about, you know, the suggestion that they pinched the tune from Puccini. Eventually, in court, they played a record of Avalon, and a trio, which I'm sure was violoncello and pianoforte, in the court, played the little bit from Tosca. Did you know this, David?
No.
No. I think it's the bit that goes da-da-da-da-da-da-dee-ba-dum-dum, which I don't think is like Avalon, but let's not reopen the case
on
now.
On a cello, it's better, though, of course.
Yes. Well, from that fascinating piece of information, back to Denis, and can you identify this tune, Denis?
Somebody Stole My Girl.
Yes. From an old record by Bix Beiderbecke, that came. Doesn't that take you back?
Yeah. He played the
no,
trumpet.
No, it doesn't. Left.
He played the trumpet.
Yeah, well, that was his pianist playing it then.
Oh, I get you now.
And on to Ian, your turn.
Remember this, a kiss is just a kiss,
This all the title you're giving me?
No. The title is As Time Goes By.
Yes. 2 marks to you. Frank's turn. That's the whole point.
Come to me, her.
Yes, my...
My hermelin, her collie, her baby.
Yeah. The score. At the moment... Oh, I can't work it out. Oh, yes. Ian Wallace and Denis Norden are leading by 3.5 marks.
We count.
Opera, as we say in France. 1 mark for the opera... 1 for the composer. David Franklin, in which opera is the Baron von Eisenstein married to a wife named Rosalinda who has a lover named Arthur?
Fledermaus.
By?
Strauss.
Yes. 1 mark for each. Very good, the Fledermaus, Johann Strauss. Denis. Yes, why not? Denis, in which opera would you find a Red Indian named Bill Jackrabbit and his squaw? It opens in the Polka Saloon, and the heroine wins a game of poker for the life of her lover.
All contributions gratefully received.
What is that?
The Girl of the Golden West, we think,
yes.
By Puccini.
Puccini, you're right, yes. And another question for Ian, since he answered that one. Ian, which opera has a prologue and an epilogue in Luther's Tavern in Nuremberg? The hero at the end falls into a drunken stupor while someone else goes off with the heroine.
I'm getting you to sort of twitch here.
Yes, right.
Because I think it might be the Tales of Hoffmann.
I'm twitching with my head up and down, yes.
Offenbach.
Yes, better Offenbach than Bach often, so you say the old guy. Yeah.
You're not saying yes, leading me on to my doom. You're saying yes.
No, you're right. You've got your 2 marks. The Tales of Hoffmann by Offenbach. Frank, can you please name the one-act music drama with libretto by Oscar Wilde?
Salome.
Which was banned by the censors in Vienna, by the Kaiser in Berlin, and by the censors in London and in America.
Salome, Salome, that's my girl, Salome, standing there.
I won't go on.
Yes, I rather think David would like it to be called Salome. I don't know. They seem to in operatic circles. By whom, for the other mark?
That was a sausage.
By whom?
By whom, yes.
Richard Strauss, of course.
Thank you, David. Yes. 2 marks. Now the singing bit. We come to some popular old songs sung by our contestants with Graham Dalley, just to start them off. Words, please, gentlemen, I keep saying every week. Words, please, as well as tunes. David Franklin.
Up there?
Anyway. I'll get a letter.
Anyway. I must have complete silence for this. It's very dangerous. Mid pleasures and palaces.
Pastime.
No interruptions, please. Where'er we may roam, be it ever so humble, there's no place like home. I haven't finished. It goes on.
Oh, yes,
home, home on the range.
You're really taking it tempo commodo. 3 marks for Home Sweet Home. And Dennis's turn.
They were sisters, we were brothers.
We were brothers, but we loved it. Two.
Then goes,
one little girl in blue.
No, one. No, it starts brother. Off with two.
It's two.
A,
two.
It's a ballad to two lady traffic wardens. And then it goes, one little girl in blue, lad, stole your father's heart. She was your... She, now she's your mother. I married the other.
You got the words there, Steve, but you didn't get the tune.
I did not
you,
get the
you
tune.
You have either one or the other.
Yes, I see. You got so many of the words wrong, you can scarcely say you got the words either. And one little girl in blue, lad, who won your father's heart, became your mother. I married the other, but now we have drifted apart.
Oh, yes.
It's a complicated relationship. Anyway, I think two marks would be generous. Out of three. Ian, before we hear your song, let me tell you, please, choose your own key. Off you go. This is Ian's turn.
Well, it falls the dew, and it's there that I love ye. Guide me, her promise true.
See now why you said choose your own key. Because I think we have to change the key.
Get me.
Say it again and again.
I go into neutral for a minute.
I promise to, which ne'er for God shall be.
Three marks for Ian Wallace and a song for and from Frank Muir. Ta-dum, ta-dum.
Ah. Hello.
Avec les paroles.
Citoyens de la patrie, ce jour de gloire est arrivé.
Vive la France!
Vive la France!
Avec non, Louise.
Scotland, vive.
C'est un pire.
Yes. You know the Marchand, Marchand bit, don't you?
Marchand.
Yes, sir. I don't see why you shouldn't have the doing two marks.
I
don't see why you shouldn't have three marks for that.
Should be a bonus mark in a foreign language. Yeah.
I have to tell you that a kindly secretary typed out for me the words in case by any chance they should forget them. They must have typed the words of the Marseillaise out from a very, very old copy, because it says here on my typescript, à l'enfant de la patrie, le jour de gloire est arrivé contre nous de la patrie. That's an essentially French. And I'm afraid that brings us to the end of this edition of My Music, in which Ian Wallace and Denis Norden win by 3.5 marks. Goodbye.
Taking part in My Music were David Franklin, Frank Muir, Denis Norden, and Ian Wallace. Graham Dalley was at the keyboard, and the chairman was Steve Ray. The questions were compiled by Edward J. Mason, and the program was produced in London by Tony Schreier.